It's showtime.
Okay, Tokyo,
South America,
Australia.
It's showtime.
Here we go. Head on with Bob Kincaid. 3 hours of conversation, cussing, and a discussing with America's only born and bred Southern liberal talk host. Head on with Bob Kincaid is brought to you each night by Coal River Mountain Watch. Coal River Mountain Watch invites you to become part of the solution, part of a sustainable future, part of the uprising against mountaintop removal. Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. And now, from high in the hills of beautiful West Bicod, Virginia, here's Bob Kincaid on the Head On Radio Network.
Well, howdy. And here we go. We are off and running, as John Fox says every evening. It's a little over a minute past the hour. It's the 19th day of November 2018. We're rapidly running out of 2018. We're going to be fresh out and up to 42 more days, 41, and just a few hours, as a matter of fact. And I think if my ciphering is, you know, me ciphering, you can never count on it. Hi, I'm Bob Kincaid. It's Moran Monday on the horn, and I'm a little bushed. I've been out raking all day. Yeah, want to make sure that we take care of our forests here in West Virginia, and I've tried to do it while speaking in a bad Finnish accent. But you know, we've got listeners in Finland, and. I gotta say, I'm a little disappointed. All these years, you never told me about the raking. What is it? Some sort of national secret? Huh? Is it? Is that what it is? Yeah. Well, the cat's out of the bag now, and we all know that we have a patriotic duty to rake, because of course we must rake America great again. Going to hell for that one. Thank God I stole it and didn't come up with it by myself. Somebody else will be going with me. Yes. In fact, I think it's a Finn who will be going with me. We may get to that in a minute. Anyway, this is The Horn. Headon.live is where we live. That's where you go if you'd like to be part of the merry, madcap, wacky, zany, real-time multimedia extravaganza that is The Horn chat room during the hours in which this program is live, Monday through Friday, 6 to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And if you do pick out a screen name and a password at headon.live, by Jove, you will be immediately greeted by the likes of Anatole and Hoghead and Otto and Rally and Warrior Witch, and capably moderated by longtime inveterate, indefatigable veteran chat room moderator Sparky, who, although he is in fact a Spacing Guild Master, has stayed there in the Spacing Guild Master Hall instead of folding space to become Man Cave, because it's a lot safer that way, and there's a lot less crap to breathe. Yes, you'll also be moderated by midweek pinch hit utility chat room moderator and all-around great guy, Steve from Georgistan, who I'm looking forward to meeting here in about a week and a half or so. Reminder, program note, stuff like that. We're moving into the holiday season. There won't be a whole lot of changes, but next week I will be gone Thursday and Friday. To go down to the Malloy Shindig in the low knee hills of the North Georgia Mountains, the lucky portion of the Appalachians that doesn't have any fucking coal under it. Yay! That's a week from Thursday and Friday. Now, this Thursday is Thanksgiving. I worked last Thanksgiving, and I might yet, but I found out yesterday that there's a potluck going on among some friends of mine, and well, Agnes and I don't have a bunch of cooking to do because the family's sort of, well, what, distributed, I guess. So we may go over for that, and that may prevent me from working Thanksgiving night. But, you know, I'll advise. So we have thanks to give out at the beginning of the week. We have to catch up with our thank yous for Saturday and Sunday and Monday. And that means, let's see, this is, okay, so we go back to the 16th. Move the mic, Bob. And we send out thanks to Joseph and Charlene. Oh, wait, that's Friday night. Okay, there it is. Samuel. Thank you, Samuel, for being a subscriber to the program and helping keep the program on the air. Thanks to Arthur as well. Thank you very kindly to our buddy Laborman, Gary, out in New Mexico. And thank you to Nancy. Those are our subscribers for the, 17th of the month. I went back a day early. And thank you very kindly as well on the 18th to our subscribers, Charlene in Rhode Island, and Grace. Thank you, Grace. And thank you very kindly to Stephen. Thank you all very much indeed. And then there was this morning. And we have thanks to send out to our buddy Dave in Tallahassee. And by the way, a note, if you get a thing saying that that we have suspended your subscription payment, please rest assured, we did not. I have not, and it's just PayPal, because Dave sent me a note, and he said, is this just PayPal being PayPal? And I said, and when I read it, I wanted to make sure that I mentioned it this evening, because yes, apparently that is PayPal being PayPal, because considering the fact that we are nowhere near the $410 a month subscribers we would desperately like to have, we're not going to run around suspending anybody's subscriptions. No, no, no. But thank you to Sharon as well. Thank you very kindly to David. And thank you very much to Joseph and to Robert and to Brock and to Mike out in Cascadia. Thank you very kindly, all, one and all. Your subscriptions knocked down about a quarter of the fundraising goal for the month, any given month, and then we try to make the rest of it up during the program. And we finished last week about $80 short, which was a whole lot better than we would have otherwise dared hope. So the fundraising goal this evening is $280. Then I had a note from Catherine, who said, she said, well, basically what it boils down to is, just a minute. I'll find it again here. There it is. I don't listen live, says Catherine, so I'm not able to participate in challenges. I wonder if there's a way to arrange that. I love the program, as always. Well, you know what? There is. Based on Catherine's kind note, and based on the fact that we have a $280 fundraising goal this evening, we will consider that a challenge on the table. And Catherine has kindly put forward $50, and that will and if that is met, if her challenge is met, that'll take us down to only $180 for this evening. So thank you very kindly, Catherine. It's kind of hard to respond to challenges the other way around, unless there's some sort of leftover, but how about we make put you on the front end of one, so maybe that'll encourage folks. But we got 280. If Catherine's challenge is met, then that'll mean we've only got 180 left after that, and we'll do all the fundraising. Hopefully, we'll keep up with fundraising through the week. I know it's Thanksgiving. I'm sorry, but that's how. That's how we keep things going here. Okay, I didn't know that. Clarity letting us know. You know, if you just type H-O-R into Chrome, bang, it's you. hearing you in Bumfor East, Oregon. Yes. Thank you, Clarity. I didn't. Maybe that's unique to you. I don't know. One never knows. One really never knows. Thank you very kindly, Paul. Wow, what? I'm just looking at all. Randy and PA said, false start, 5-yard penalty. No, that wasn't a false start. That was actually me forgetting to turn off the autoplay audio over on HeadOn.live when I go to the chat room. Never a dull moment. Yeah. And apparently we are up and running on both streams. That's wonderful. That's just perfectly grand. No, the MP3 stream is not down. It's up, so says Randy, Marty. Marty, Randy, Randy, Marty. Now we got enough for bridge. Okay, so more in Monday, right? That's where we are. And I know, raking, right? So we've got that much moranity. But I've got a special moran. I've got a moran. Well, I mean, this just leapt off the monitor at me. But in honor of the manifest moranity that did go down this weekend, what with the new requirement that all Americans rake the forest like a fin. I mean, that's, yeah, yeah. Well, let's do check in. Let's check in on, yes, it not just, you're right, Marty, not just raking, but raking in Pleasure, California. Oh, Dr. Freud, what a good time you missed by checking out when you, yeah. He changed Paradise, California to Pleasure. Pleasure, California. Yes, pleasure. Maybe when we rebuild it, we'll call it pleasure instead of paradise. And then today he was patting the ass of a horse. No, that is not a melanoma joke. Now stop that. They deliver the White House Christmas tree to the White House by horse-drawn wagon. And he walked up to the southbound end of a northbound horse and patted its cute little rump. There was no open mic, so we don't know if he then followed it up by saying, "You were great. You reminded me of Ivanka." To me, it was like, I don't know, it's like a Mr. Magoo cartoon. You know. Oh, Justice Kavanaugh, so great. So glad you could make it today. But anyway, back to the fins. We have here a good example of a fin who, of course, does his patriotic duty of raking.
Hello, America, and hello, Mr. President Donald Trump. Like President Trump said, we Finns, we spend a lot of time on raking, cleaning and doing things. That's how we prevent wildfires. It doesn't have to do anything with our climate. No. Although it rains like hell and it's cold as fuck, we have to rake. It's mandatory in Finland, we have to rake 2 hours per day. But yeah, we got the greatest rakes in the world. Fiskars.
It had to be Fiskars rakes. Yeah. I mean, how do you think the Finns beat the piss out of the Russians? The Russians came pouring over the Finnish frontier and they did not have their rakes with them, but the Finns did. And for a while there, it was house-to-house raking. But eventually, the Russians turned and fled because they knew that they would never be able to rake on a par with the Finns. Because, of course, they had the very best rakes. Fiskars.
Yeah, we got the greatest rakes in the world. Fiskars. it's easy to rake with them and to prevent wildfires. It's really great. We even have rake in universities in Finland. That's how we learn to rake in our estates.
And you know what? You know what? Their raking universities are tuition free. And raking in the Finnish elementary school system is largely unstructured. The teachers aren't there yelling, rake, rake, rake more, rake for Finland. They aren't doing that, especially because that's a horrible Finnish accent. No, they let the children sort of organically figure out the necessity of raking, and pretty soon they leave the jungle gyms and the monkey bars and everything, and they go over and they just happen to notice there's a stack of rakes over there, and the next thing you know, the forest around the school has been raked to perfection. Yes, yes.
No, anytime. You're welcome back to Finland, Mr. Trump. And we can teach you how to rake. It's really easy. It's great. And we clean our forest floors with the cleanest water on earth. It's the greatest water on earth. So welcome back to Finland and rake America great again.
See, that's what I meant when I said I wouldn't have to go to hell by myself. Rake America great again. Yes. Yeah, I mean, everybody got a good laugh. The Finns, I never knew the Finns were funny people. Yeah, I confess to thinking that Scandinavian Nordic folks are kind of not funny. Dour and grim, but this guy's obviously got some pretty dry humor. Yeah, I mean, there's even raking clothes. They rake in Sweden, too. And in fact, there's a noteworthy clothing brand over there called Fjallraken. 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 And their clothing has a little leather patch with a fox holding a rake in a forest. Yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, and the Finns had a wonderful time over the weekend after Donald Trump announced that he had learned about forest raking from the president or prime minister or exalted noble pish-posh of Finland. No offense. I mean, just I'm not sure because it pretty much exists only in the thin gray settlings that are mostly made up of slithering spirochetes that slosh around between Trump's ears and pass for brains. Now, the Finns had a great time with us. There were actually photos on social media. I know, we're talking about a photo on a radio program. Bear with me. There were photos on social media of Finnish women standing among trees holding vacuum cleaners. And I laughed right along with them until I didn't. Until it dawned on me. And you know, we like to think we're funny people, Americans, because a lot of the funniest people on earth were persecuted because they were funny. And things like Jewish or black or Muslim or whatever, and wound up kind of having to leave. British, Irish, Scots. But somehow or another, they found a way to laugh, and they found it in America. And so we're proud of our comic tradition. Whether it be the slapstick of the olden days and Charlie Chaplin or Buster Keaton or God knows W.C. Fields, up through Lenny Bruce and George Carlin and Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy, in the modern day, Eliza Schlesinger. One of the stories that came out, because it's more in Monday. You know the nerd prom? The White House Correspondents Association dinner? Well, they have announced that there will be no comedian for this year's White House Correspondents Association Nerd Prom. And I'm not going to waste a lot of energy getting all broken up about what they do or don't do at that soiree for the multimillionaire media. Except to say that that's fucking pathetic. It really, really is. They canceled the comedian. They canceled the comedian because Trump doesn't laugh. And he's not going to show up anyway. And he'll just send somebody that'll get pissed off. And get all umbrajaded. So the White House Correspondents Association knuckled under, having previously, because Michelle Fox nailed this White House to the wall the last time through, you know, pointing out that the woman that Trump sent as his surrogate, Sarah Hasselbeck Sandbags, is a notorious pathological liar. And you might recall, after that dust up, the head of the White House Correspondents Association apologized for what First Amendment stuff Michelle Fox had, Michelle Wolf had offered up as in the way of the First Amendment. And in the way of speaking truth to power. So now there won't be a comedian. Because they can't find a comedian who wouldn't be offensive to Julius Geezer. It reminds me of the time they brought doddering old Rich Little out because they were afraid of offending George W. Bush. But this time they just said, fuck it, no funny. We're not even gonna. So they're gonna invite presidential historian Ron Chernow. And if Ron Chernow talks about presidential history, by comparison, any comparison with any other president is going to make Trump look bad. So I'm sure the head of the White House Correspondents Association will have to apologize for that, too. But because I'm a huge fan, I'm sitting here wondering, did anybody even call Eliza Schlesinger? Because God Almighty, I mean, I don't know about you, but she makes me laugh so hard that the tears fall. I mean, the kind of breathless, can't stop laughing, can't get your stomach begins to hurt, wonder if you're going to pee kind of helpless laughter. And not just wondering, hoping you don't. And she probably could have offered some pretty, because she's not overtly political, but she offers some insights. And this having just completed an election cycle that was referred to as the year of the woman, might have been pretty good. I mean, heck, a bit with Kellyanne Conway crawling on the floor, dumping out her bag, looking for her cosmetics. That bit that she did, magnificent. Just rework it, you know, retool it. But no, we're going to get Ron Chernow. Stephen New York says, is that like a real historian or a David Barton historian? No, he's real. He's real. I mean, he's no John Meacham, but he's real. Actually, he's probably a few levels above Ron Meacham, John Meacham, but anyway. But the problem is, if he tries to talk about the presidency at all, he's going to wind up offending Trump and the Republicans. Because Donald Trump cannot withstand comparison to any other president, not even George W. Dim Leader Bush. He can't withstand a comparison to Franklin Pierce, the single drunkest president we've ever had. The only possible comparison is with James Buchanan, our only bachelor president, who was so ineffective and so far up the South's ass that by virtue of his ineffectiveness and his dawdling unwillingness to do dick, got us into a civil war. Yeah, please remember, Lincoln wasn't inaugurated until March of 1861. Just, you know, keep that in mind. Yeah. So, again, there are lots of morons. We have tons of potential this evening. Lee in New York with a note. Subject line, Norwegian humor. Tech humor via Norway. You will enjoy it. Do not play it on the podcast. Only the subtitles are English. Medieval help desk. Oh, goodness me. And Ron in Raleigh asks, did I hear, was that Arnie Kincaidman I heard earlier? Another distant relative, I assume? You know, Ron, it's almost like you've got the entire six-volume set of the Kincaid family history sitting right there at your fingertips down in Raleigh. Yes, that was Arnie Kincaidman, as a matter of fact. Yeah, mm-hmm. And that's worth a cowbell. Absolutely. Lee in New York says, if Trump finds horses attractive, then when he called Stormy Daniels horse face, it was possibly a compliment. Oh, way to stitch together a couple of disparate moments. That well played. Well played indeed. You know, I really don't know. Steve in New York asking, query, what exactly does it mean to do dick? By the way, given these times, do not the morons just overwhelm us? Are there so many as to render the designation useless? Well, Steve, we've got to hang on to something resembling norms, whether the norms want to be hung on to or not. Norm! Ow! But we've got to pretend that we're not living in complete and total chaos. Franklin Pierce asks Jack in Shreveport, a drinker, huh? Is that why Hawkeye was such a drinker and named Benjamin Franklin Pierce? Ben Franklin drank a lot too, didn't he? Well, I know he did tipple some because he went and he went and did some ale swilling and probably cider quaffing with Agnes's great 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 grandfather. It's fact. Hard cider. Maybe even mead. Who knows? Yeah. Yeah, that was good, too. Marty points out, my favorite of the raking jokes is the one with a Roomba doing its rounds in a Finnish forest. Yeah, say Finnish forest three times fast. You think you're so smart. It rains like hell and it's cold as fuck. I didn't even know Finns talked like that. But that's just a brief survey of the stupidity with which we have been inundated over the course of the weekend. But then there's this. And you know, you're probably not going to hear this on any other broadcasts. Because I do. I pay attention to the little things. And I saw this earlier today, and it comes out of the absolute hippest place in all of North Carolina, Stan. Yes. It comes from Asheville, North Carolina. And it's a story out of a private school, probably a private Jesus-y kind of school. We'll do the front end of the story first. One, It's a little bit shocking. Oh, wait a minute. What's that? How about that? I didn't know that. Elbert in Rhode Island pointing out, Hermann Göring placed a large bounty on the head of a U.S. bomber crewman. His name was Clark Gable. Huh? Let us... I was thinking just yesterday, I need to go out and buy a new edition of Trivial Pursuit. Who knows what kind of stuff is in there since I last played it 30 years ago. Although, if there are questions about the Jonas Brothers or NSYNC or the Backstreet Boys, probably screwed. Never mind. Asheville, North Carolina has become famous for something they didn't want to be famous for. As I said, Asheville, North Carolina is probably the absolute hippest place in North Carolina. I mean, you probably can't even buy a Bud Light in Asheville, North Carolina. It's probably all craft beers up there and out there, down there. It's down there from here, but never mind. All the bread is probably vegan and cruelty free and cage free and free range and gluten free and right. It's just hip. I mean, Asheville is so hip that the minute you cross the county line, men immediately sprout a humongous neck beard. I'm being unfair to Asheville. It's a lovely place. But it's not a place you necessarily want to go right now. Because right now, Asheville is experiencing the largest chickenpox outbreak in 20 years. The outbreak is taking place at one of those private schools called Asheville Waldorf School. Probably has something to do with the proximity to the Waldorf Astoria. I don't know. No. That's an... Oh, there's some humongous goddamn castle built by a robber baron from the 19th century. There, somebody will tell me. But not, whatever. Maybe it's because they eat Waldorf salad there. Who knows? But the Asheville Waldorf School has 36 students sick as of this past Friday with chickenpox. Now, just a general reminder, chickenpox is not a throwaway, who cares? It's miserable. I guess it's possible to have a mild case of chickenpox, but a mild case of chickenpox is still no fun. When adults or very, very young infants get it, it can be life-threatening. And in fact, we experienced something similar to that. It was early in 1996. Ferg was just newly born, and our eldest brought home chickenpox from school. And this is before the era of the chickenpox vaccine, or before it was routinely available. And so Ferg, literally just months old, and Agnes, who had never had chickenpox, both caught it, and they caught it with a vengeance. When we took Ferg to the pediatrician, he said, "Oh, he doesn't just have chickenpox; he's got bolus chickenpox, great big, humongous, honking chickenpox, and he's still got a few scars." Do you have any idea what it's like to try to explain to tell a newborn not to scratch while they're still working out the whole coordination of the limbs thing? And Agnes got so sick she thought that she was going to die. And the chicken pox can kill people who get it as an adult. Like I said, this is a story about Asheville, North Carolina, and the chickenpox. Oh, yeah, the Biltmore, not the Waldorf Astoria, but weren't they both Vanderbilt operations? Never mind, but thank you, Ron. Thank you, I appreciate it. Anyway, back to... So they got 36 kids sick with chickenpox at the Asheville Waldorf School. Bear with me. We'll get there. And it turns out that they have 36 kids with the chickenpox at the Waldorf School because, well, the county where the Waldorf School is, namely, I think, Buncombe County, North Carolina, has the highest rate of unvaccinated children for religious exemptions than all but two other schools in the state. For instance, 28 kindergartners enrolled in the 2017-2018 year at Asheville's Waldorf School. 28. And of those 28, 19 of the children had a religious exemption for at least one vaccination required by the state of North Carolina for a child to be able to enter school. Which brings us to the point that, well, if you've got a law on the books that supposedly is a requirement for children to be able to enter school, and the child can say, "Ooh, but my," because the child's not going to say, no child wants chicken pox. But it's not the child saying, well, my invisible friend in the sky, the big bearded juvenile delinquent, or the earth mother, or whatever, you know, who cares, deities is deities, says, I ain't supposed to have no vaccination, or the all-powerful deity of the universe won't love me no more. Nineteen kids out of 28, their parents said that. But if you've got one of those exemptions, then you don't have a requirement. The Asheville Waldorf School has a student body that runs from nursery age through sixth grade. Now, those other two schools have a 100% exemption rate. Jesus. What a cesspool of germs that place must be. And I'll bet you Jesus is not particularly good at keeping the kids from getting sick. So, as Susan Sullivan, a nurse with the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, who works with local health departments about vaccines and diseases that are preventable, said, the thing people need to understand is that when you have pockets of unvaccinated people, they serve as reservoirs for disease. That's just about the very same damned thing. That's the definition of a cesspool. Lee in New York says, chickenpox. I had chickenpox the year before the vaccine. My friend Sinclair got it at age 93. Well, I had it in second grade. I had mumps, measles, and chickenpox. Bang, 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 bang. It was a bad year. Hated missing, too, because I loved my teacher. Wonderful. But I didn't get out of homework just because chickenpox. Oh, no, they sent it home. But we have a vaccine now for chickenpox, and there's a reason for it. Because the same virus that causes chickenpox after you've had the chickenpox, well, it doesn't go away. It terminates and stays resident inside the fluid of your spinal column. And then later in life, at a time when you'd really not like to have it happen, It can, for reasons unknown, flare up again and turn into something that we know as shingles. And shingles, in turn, are a sojourn in hell. It generally happens around the abdomen. It can cause permanent neurologic damage. I know this because I watched my father go through it, and he was in agony for over a year. But if you vaccinate against chickenpox, you probably got a good chance you're not going to get shingles later in life. As it is, I had chickenpox. I didn't have it. But so, you know, when I crossed 50, back when I had health care coverage, I got a shingles vaccine. Made me sick for a couple of days. But I am pretty well protected against getting the shingles. And again, having watched my father go through it, I don't want to go through it either. So that's the backstory. A bunch of people with more dollars than cents who are spending their money to send children to a private school, because public schools, in one of the toniest areas of North Carolina, and Asheville is tony, have decided they would like to make sure that it's more important to them to keep their invisible friend happy. And I suspect they're not even, it's not, it had, really has nothing to do with their invisible friend. It has everything to do with, because, you know, it's not just them, the other side. It's our side, too. We got some Lulus in our camp as well, who don't understand the concept of immunity. And the fact that one of those little kids, if they get around an infant who hasn't been vaccinated yet, well, they can kill the infant. The fact of the matter is, in Buncombe County, North Carolina, they've got a lot of people who don't vaccinate, who seek those religious exemptions. And it's because they're afraid of the vaccines and not afraid of the disease. Take, for instance, a person interviewed for the course of this story over at comes from KARE11. I mean, that's where I found it, in Minneapolis. Why Minneapolis is covering a North Carolina story, I don't know, but I'm glad they are. The story, among other things, cites, again, this nurse, Susan Sullivan, and says that in the 1980s, when she was working as a nurse at Johns Hopkins in the oncology unit, she became acquainted with a little elementary age girl who had just finished leukemia treatment and went back home, and some little kid with chickenpox came along. And as Ms. Sullivan put it, Nurse Sullivan put it, because her immune system was brand spanking new, the disease spread to her internal organs, and she did not survive. That was a wake-up call to me that this is not a benign childhood illness. Of course, you could also ask people in Native American communities, because things like measles, chickenpox, the flu, the common cold, smallpox, were responsible for a disease-induced genocide among the native peoples of this hemisphere, the likes of which the world has never seen, or had never seen at the time. Tens of millions of people wiped out by diseases brought by the Europeans, to which they had largely become immune through contact. Immunity. There's a term for them. They're called virgin soil epidemics. And they raged throughout this hemisphere as a result of Europeans bringing their diseases to people who had no immunity for it. And so here's the moron part of the story. If a bunch of parents not immunizing their children isn't moronical enough. Here's the moron. Here's the part that when I read it earlier today, I went, oh, this is going right to the top of Moran Monday. No doubt about it. We have a name to put with this story. And it really brings everything into focus. Now, again, remember, there are about 3.5 million cases of chickenpox every year in this country. Well, there are 3.5 million cases, there would be, but they're stopped by the chickenpox vaccine. This is data from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Nonetheless, chickenpox leads to 9,000 hospitalizations every year and 100 deaths. So now, let's check in with the reason this story is part of Moran Monday. And the reason this story is part of Moran Monday is particularly Asheville, North Carolina resident Amy Gordon. Amy Gordon. Oh, I just bet you she's got a refrigerator full of soy milk and almond milk and free-range, cruelty-free vegan peanut butter and all kinds. Or maybe she's just a right-wing religious weirdo, but I'm edging toward the other end of the spectrum just because it's Asheville. Interviewed for the story, Amy Gordon said, "What's the big deal with chickenpox? There is no big deal. If I was a parent with a kid who wasn't vaccinated, I'd want to send my kid to the Waldorf school to get chickenpox." Is that you, Lord? Because I just heard a voice saying, she's an idiot. Oh, no, that was Agnes. Yes, Agnes, who still very well remembers the chicken pox that she lived through when it was brought home from school. Yeah, I mean, granted, I didn't fire up the Calliope or anything, but here, what's the big deal with chicken pox? There's no big deal. If I was a parent with a kid who wasn't vaccinated, I'd want to send my kid to the Waldorf school to get chicken pox.
You've got to remember that these are just simple farmers. These are people of the land. You know, morons.
Jesus, yes. Oh, well, I pissed somebody off. Marty says, "Oi! I have and drink almond milk and use coconut milk in my coffee." I'm sorry. I mean, they're stereotypes because, well, they fit. Meanwhile, it turns out that they interviewed Asheville resident Amy Gordon, but Asheville resident Amy Gordon's children were vaccinated for things like polio and whooping cough and measles and mumps in the late 1980s when she was raising little ones. But that was before the chickenpox vaccine became available. Hence, if I was a parent with a kid who wasn't vaccinated, I'd want to send my kid to the Waldorf school to get chickenpox. Because, you know, them vaccines is dangerous. Yeah. The Amy Gordons of the world are how we got here, or how we got here. I don't know. I'm of two minds on this, because the other part of me goes, I bet I know who she voted for president in 2016. But the thing is, with the vaccine question, you cannot be certain. No, you can't. So that's just one more in. Meanwhile, a note coming in from Terrace. Shingles of the government. I don't want to see Orangina's tax returns. I already know what's in them. I don't care about the Mueller investigation. I already know who the traitors are. I just want King Dong to leave the White House in 2 years. Can he accept defeat from anyone? Perhaps Beto? Call me a pussy, but I don't want a civil war. I don't want one neither. And, yeah, if I understand your analogy correctly, Terrace, having Trump in the White House is a lot like having shingles in the government. It causes you pain that you never imagined you would feel. What's all the big deal with chickenpox? Yeah, ask a 4-month-old baby who has to have his hands wrapped to keep him from touching the blisters and the sores that break out, and screams in abject agony because he's brand new to this planet and he doesn't know what itching means, and he's not real good at that art of word knowing at 3 months yet. If I was a parent with a 3-month-old who wasn't vaccinated, I'd want to send my 3-month-old to the Waldorf school to get chicken pox. Jesus, I hope a hole opens up in the air. No, I'm not going to just... But God, the stupid! Okay, let's go over and I'll just calm down now. But I hope you understand why that just rocketed right to the top of the list. I mean, more in Monday and all. But I've got Steve from Georgia staying on the line. What's up, Steve?
Brother Bob, what's going on, my friend?
I don't know, but stay away from Asheville unless you've had your chickenpox vaccine and your shingles vaccine.
Oh, I get it, man. I get it. It's both equally important.
I mean, can you help me here? I mean, what kind of a rock do these people live under?
A rock that you and I can't wrap our heads around. Because the rock we wrap our heads around makes sense. And these people make no sense whatsoever.
I mean, what was it, 2 years ago when Kenneth Copeland's daughter, who is a second-generation evangelical televangelist, got her weird-ass little cult in Texas to eschew vaccinations, and then suddenly Texas had one of the largest measles outbreaks in the entire, in 100 years or something?
I tell you, the world's gone flipping mad, and I hate to be a little ray of sunshine, but it's getting worse. I see it in my daily observations every day, and I had something happen to Karen and I today that I wanted to share with you.
Oh, do please.
And Karen was like, you've got to share this with Bob. This is just so far beyond the pale.
Then I want to know.
We went to our local pharmacist today. It's a little country pharmacy store, and everything is cool. Usually there's nothing happening, nothing going on. But happened to be when we walked in front of the store, there was this, I want to call her a girl, a nice young lady. I want to call her even nice. And I want to give anybody the better benefit of the doubt. But she was just jabbering, gibberish, coherentness, crazy talk. And I was like, my God, what is she doing here? And she kept blabbering on and on with this craziness. And I walked past Karen, and of course Karen stayed with her. Karen's always trying to cure the sick and heal the sore, you know, and I'm down with that. But
in other words, Miss Karen is a compassionate human being.
Right, right. And she's always trying to get inside of people's heads to find out, you know.
Oh, no, Karen, no, don't go there.
Why are you sounding so crazy?
It's scary, you know? And full of spiders.
Yeah, and it gets worse, Bob. It gets so much worse.
Of course it does.
It's come time for me to check out, and I finally got my meds together, which hold my sanity together. And, you know, it was nothing that big. It was just, you know, medicine that wasn't mental medicine. It was medicine for other things. But anyhow, I noticed that this girl was in front of me, this crazy girl that had scared the hell out of me just 10 minutes beforehand, was strapped with a Glock 9.
Run.
And I'm like, oh my God, she's strapped. And that's the only thing I could think was to blurt out. And the whole store looked at me like it was a Pulp Fiction movie or something.
Well, of course, you never know. Well, of course she's strapped. ISIS MS-13 may invade us at any minute now. They're already taking over houses up in northern Minnesota.
She had her freedom detector, Bob. And
she may have been so good at it, she could take her prescription, dump out a little pill on her hand, throw it up in the air, and bang, blow the pill away.
But what was scaring me, Bob, is she could have got a letter from one of her jilted boyfriends or something. Wasn't a bad-looking girl. But, I mean, who knows how stable anybody is nowadays. She could have gotten a phone call that could have just set her off. And here she is strapped with a Glock 9. And I'm thinking, my God, what have we become?
We have become very paranoid, very terrified, and very nuts.
Well, does that mean I'm paranoid? I know you didn't.
No, not you, them. You're not afraid to go to the pharmacy without without major ordinance hanging off your hip.
But it just didn't dawn on me that, my God, this girl is strapped to the gills.
Cray cray.
And I was like, and I told Karen, I was like, I've got to call Bob. I've got to let him know about this. I've got to purge myself of this because this is just too much for me to try to process. And I want his take on this.
So are you an open carry state and a permitless concealed carry state?
Yes, and a stand your ground state.
Because, see, I was going to mention to you, you know, you said she was just babbling gibberish and stuff.
Right. When we first got there, she showed me her phone and said, look at my phone. It flashes on and off, on and off, on and off. Well, most phones do that, you know.
Look at my phone. Pet my phone. Pet it. Pet it.
It's on now. It's off now. It's on now. It's off now.
And that's when you saw the firearm.
And that's when I saw the craziness behind her eyes. And I knew that the lights were on, but there was nobody home. And as long as we keep allowing this kind of crap.
Well, you know, when being crazy and armed is outlawed, only armed crazy people will be something like that. But it has real world ramifications. Of course, we're dealing we're dealing with another day now, Steve, where a week after having the National Rubel Association tell physicians to stay in their lane and not talk about firearms deaths as a public health crisis. Well, lo and behold, Mercy Hospital, Chicago, six people were shot this afternoon. And the doctors are kind of saying, okay, what lane now?
And the better angel of my nature would like to say to you, well, she probably just had a bad day, blah, 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 blah. No, this girl wasn't having a bad day. This girl was fucking crazy, and she was strapped with a goddamn Glock 9 on her hip that could have presented
harm. Yeah, probably a good 17, 18, 19 rounds in that little bastard, right?
Yes. Yes, and it scared the fuck out of me.
About 100, about 100, about what, 120 grain bullet?
It scared the fuck out of me, and I'm sorry for cursing on your show. I don't mean to do that.
I think you're the only one who still does. Feel free. Let 1,000 F-bombs bloom, okay? I mean...
But what have we become? This is beyond the pale. We have to rein this shit in, or we're all going to wind up dead.
Well, as long as the NRA exists, we ain't reining shit in. And that's a fact. As long as the Republican Party controls the Senate, we ain't reining shit in. As long as there's a Republican in the White House, we ain't reining shit in. I mean, and not to seamlessly change topics on you or anything, Steve, but I'd like for us to focus on, like I said the other night, dream big. Dream of an expanded Democratic majority in the House in 2020 and beating every Republican running for Senate. Dream big.
So you think that's more of a productive solution than to have people like Karen and Agnes try to talk to these people on a one-on-one
basis? Well, I know it's a better solution than having a bunch of cranky old white guys running around the House of Representatives saying, "Let's just sign the letter. I won't vote for Nancy Pelosi." Really, we got so much power in the Democratic Party now that we can afford to waste time with internecine bloodlettings. No pun intended. I mean that shit just makes me crazy, Steve. But no, what I was going to tell you is a week ago, and I told you. Agnes went for a stress test.
Yep.
And I'm not telling tales out of school. I mean, I don't think she minds me. Hang on a minute.
No, Agnes is cool. She wouldn't care.
Okay, I gotta know. Because, so she sits down there at the stress test, and she's, you know, because there's some waiting involved. You gotta let the radioactive goblolly run through you, and then they take pictures, and then you go run your ass off on the treadmill, and they take more pictures, and yeah, so she's sitting there doing the waiting part, and a woman in the waiting room starts, I kind of wish I had her here to tell it, starts going on about her, about God, Jesus, you believe in God, God loves you.
Jesus is going to save your strep test.
And after, if I understand correctly, after a while, Agnes looked at her and said, "There's a lot of chairs in here. Why don't you go sit in another one?"
I don't want to hear about Jesus. No, not when I'm in my stress test. No, leave me alone. God damn.
Hang on, I'm getting a translation, Steve. Oh, yeah, she told her she was going to die. Oh, that's what it was. Apparently, she was there for one, too. She would have been happy with Amy Gordon there in Asheville, North Carolina, because she said, you know, you're going to die. You're putting something in your body for that test that God didn't intend to be in your body, and I done told him I ain't going to have none of that.
The diagnostic dye is going to kill you.
I mean,
good God, what have we become? Where are we going? Where have we been?
Well, you know, I don't think Scott and San Diego will get all burned up if we borrow it. We're all screwed, Steve.
I love Scott and San Diego. I hope we'll call tonight. Maybe he can make some sense out of this shit that I seen tonight. It totally scrambled me. And the only thing that I knew to do was, and Karen even said, call Bob.
Yeah, you know, you got to get it out of your system, Steve. Otherwise, it'll.
And on that note, I'm going to let you go, brother. And I appreciate you letting me process the craziness that I experienced.
Oh, absolutely.
Today.
But before you leave, you've gotten a note from Lee in New York. Subject line, it goes off and on. From Steve and Karen's story, I was thinking about a scene from All in the Family. The refrigerator was being repaired. Repairman, does the refrigerator light work? Edith, off and on. Repairman, off and on. Edith Bunker, on when I open the door and off when I close it.
Like Juliette Lewis in Natural Born Killers. Till death do us part.
Exactly. Hang in there, Steve.
All right, Bob. I will be crossing paths with you soon.
Yes, indeed.
We won't be doing any Budweiser cross drinking, but maybe you're into German beer. I'll find something.
I can't drink, Steve.
I'm like that little devil.
It's not a joke. I mean, that's not a joke. I can't drink. So
okay, all right.
But I would probably get a kick out of watching you drink a like triple Russian organic Saison Imperial IPA stout something.
Nah, screw that, Bob. Just being, close enough to you, just the hangout. That's a word enough for me, man.
Well, I'm looking forward to it, Steve.
We'll do it, brother. Thanks for taking my call, okay?
No, thanks for making it. Later.
All right, man. Later.
It's our buddy Steve from Georgia Stan. Lines are open. 304-574-8178 is one of the lines. The other line is the stress line, which is both 304-640-2829. And, as you can find it on the headon.live page, 844-843-4676, toll free from anywhere in the United States, Mexico, or Canada. We are still waiting for our first call from Quintana Roo. From atop the pyramid at Chichen Itza, but until then, anybody else can jump in too. Oh, by the way, I'll be waiting since it's more in Monday. I'll be waiting for the for-profit media and especially the New York Times, to begin a 24/7 permanent hissy over precious Ivanka. Yeah, it turns out that according to the Washington Post, quote, Ivanka Trump sent hundreds of emails last year to White House aides, cabinet officials, and her assistants using a personal email account, many of them in violation of federal records rules, according to people familiar with the White House examination of her correspondence. Some aides were startled by the volume of Ivanka Trump's personal emails and taken aback by her response when questioned about the practice. Trump said she was not familiar with some details of the rules, according to people with knowledge of her reaction. Peter Mirajanian, spokesperson for Abby Lowell, Ivanka's personal attorney, said, while transitioning into government after she was given an official account, but until the White House provided her the same guidance they had given others who started before she did, Ms. Trump sometimes used her personal account, almost always for logistics and scheduling concerning her family. But her emails... Yeah. I got that in a note earlier from our buddy Silent R. Lamar. Breaking news, Ivanka Trump emails, oh my. Yeah, somehow or another, I don't know why, but I just have this abiding suspicion that it's not going to be treated with quite the same sense of breathless outrage as Hillary Clinton's were, and gosh, I have no idea why. None at all. Meanwhile, let's run back to the phones and back over to the stress line and find out who we got out westward way. Hey, welcome to the program. Wrong button. Hey, how you doing?
Es ist Ado der Schad hier. Und heute, ich werde nach Deutschland gehen. Oh, sorry, wrong meeting.
Wrong meeting.
I always want to do that when I speak. I start rallying off some German. And then go, oh my God, it's wrong meeting.
Well, you know, I'm glad the horn can exist to check that box on the bucket list.
No, I just want to appreciate that little thing you did about my dad last Friday. That was cool.
That was the coolest clip I've seen in a long time, because, again, I will repeat, I have never ever seen Richard Pryor reduced to speechlessness.
Oh, yeah. No, he's usually the main man, you know. And he couldn't get a word in edgewise either. My dad had, Carson. That's the first time I ever seen that. He used to get royalty checks from Carson way into his late 70s from the Best of Carson. And he's got another one where he upstages Carson. He found out later that Carson didn't like that. But my dad started early. He was like kind of like you. He had a whole 5-minute show after Let's Make a Deal that was local. And then it went syndicated. CBS bought it. And then they gave him his first book, which was The Children's Doctor with Lyndon Smith. And then his career just zoomed. The Life magazine did a big black and white photo spread of him. And, he won an Emmy in 71 for My Mom's Having a Baby. I went to Europe with him. They sent me off to France, and I studied in Paris, thanks to Dad's money, you know. So I was kind of like a spoiled kid, but I was different than the Trump family. I went left-wing. They went all right-wing or stupid. The Trump kids are just dumb, you know. Especially Don Jr. And Donald even mentioned that Eric is an idiot in private to somebody. But, I have a privileged life up to a point, but I had to work hard for what I have. You know, my dad wasn't going to just throw money at us. It's a hard act to follow when your dad's a celebrity like that, because a lot of people give you crap. He says, what's your problem, you know? And so I kind of went through life with low self-esteem with that. But, you just get over it. But I miss him. He died in 2001. And he had prostate cancer, but it affected his mind. His heart stopped, and he had a stroke. But he just died a few weeks after 9/11. But... which is too bad, because we were making like little videos of forced cable access. And if you go to my site, you can watch a couple of videos of him talking about frequently asked questions women have about their kids. But he was down on vaccines later in life. I don't know about the that one vaccine for chickenpox. That's an important one, no doubt. But, you know, he felt that, what's it going to do? How do they know it's going to work? You know, but, you know, a lot of people didn't like my father because he was kind of against allopathic medicine. He felt you should treat the symptom before anything else. I mean, you prevent the symptom, don't treat the symptom. But, you know, you eat right, you're healthy and whatnot. But I found that I was an alcoholic. I had to quit, but I was too hypoglycemic to handle alcohol. So you mentioned you can't drink. I'm like you. I can't drink either. I'm 22 years sober. No.
You got me beat by a right long shot.
Oh really?
At 22 years. No, I just reached a point where I've got this thing in my innards where like my gallbladder probably needs to come out and need to lop a little bit off the top of my pancreas, and my spleen won't let me play golf anymore, and and it's all this big party that gets caused by the fact that my ancient Northern European genetics want me to live in a miserable, frozen, fucking miserable, goddamn, did I mention miserable wasteland, and be fat, and just make fat, lots of fat.
Right, right. Well, I'm exactly like that. I was type 2 diabetic. I was 60 pounds overweight, and I got a job for the district as custodian, and I lost all the weight.
Well, I was there, too. You know, I was... You know, I still check my blood sugar every morning and everything, but, you know, they had me on the metformin, and the metformin made me worse.
Right.
Because...
Oh, I hear that stuff. It makes you poop all the time.
Well, and not just that, but apparently it didn't get along with the other things that I was taking to try to, you know, try to mitigate my fats and my cholesterols and my, I can never remember. I think I like the HDL and I don't like the LDL, but they can't measure them. And they used to take my, you know, I'd go for cheap blood work Tuesday or whatever, and they'd put my blood in the centrifuge and they'd go, "God damn, Bob, that just looks like butter on the top. Son of a bitch, I ain't never seen nothing like that."
Oh my God, no! Oh, that's terrible, man.
I'm just genetically predisposed for that crap.
Well, same here. Is your family Scandinavian?
No, I mean we're but see that
British.
Yeah, we're English and Scottish and German, yeah. And
yeah.
Mostly English and Scottish and Welsh and Irish, all of whom, you know, had infusions of genetics from up near the goddamned Arctic Circle, I guess. And so, you know, bring on, you know, not only predisposed to manufacture them in my body, but predisposed to want them really bad. Oh, wait, I could, yeah. I don't know. I could have the yogurt parfait for breakfast, or I could have the biscuits and gravy. Fuck it, bring the biscuits and gravy.
See, I just can't do any carbs. Like, I crave butter, I crave mashed potatoes, all that stuff, but my diet is so boring, and I had to go back on a boring diet because my A1C was 5.4, it jumped up to 5.9. I gained like 10 pounds of blubber, and I gained fat real easily. So I have to watch everything I eat. I have to bike every day. But for a 62-year-old, I'm really healthy. But, you know, my dad used to always say that eat the foods that our ancestors ate 20,000 years ago, and that's lean meats and fruits and vegetables. But when we were in Africa, he was influenced by a guy by the name of Weston Price who traveled throughout Europe and throughout the third world countries in the 1920s and 30s. And they introduced cornmeal like around the 1910s, these people, and he saw the effects of this terrible food. And he photographed people's dental arches. And then you go to a different tribe where they would be eating right, you can see the difference. They had their teeth was terrible. So when we were in Kenya, we saw people's really healthy teeth. I even filmed it. I made a little African video for his lectures. And it's interesting, but if you eat what people used to eat, like, I'm half Scandinavian, and I love fish. And so my diet is fish and rocks, you know, or fish lentils. I mean, I got to eat.
Bring me a fish and a rock, goddammit, I'm going to eat.
Yeah, but the Norwegians weren't making breads with sugars. You know, when sugar was introduced, it really screwed people's health up, especially in Europe in the early 19th century. People don't, you know about that, and alcoholism throughout Europe was terrible, you know. And I think it's people get this craving for sugar. Once that happens, you get this craving for booze or whatever, and that's kind of what happened to me. But I don't want to talk about myself. I'm just saying that, you know, you just have to be aware about your body, and he kept stressing, you know, read your body. How do you feel? And I've noticed that I have to munch on some protein like nuts and seeds and whatnot every 15 minutes. And if I drink a cup of coffee, I start getting a headache because I know my blood sugar is dropping. I don't need to check my blood sugar. I can feel it.
And oh, no. I'm right there. I mean, we love to go out and walk the trails around here and everything. And I learned the hard way that I do not go without a couple of those bottles of, you know, liquid sugar shots. Because I start exerting myself and my blood sugar goes, fuck it. And
right.
Just right in the, and yeah, you can feel it. You sweat,
you get
the shakes, you start coming unglued.
And if your blood sugar drops too much, your adrenals kick in and then you get that all gone feeling, which I can't stand, and my heart races and I can't sleep at night.
Oh, I know that real well.
And so I have to, when I used to drink, I have to eat a lot of, you know, protein, keep the blood sugar up. And some nights I didn't do that. I'd wake up in the middle of the night, cold sweats, heart palpitating, feeling like crap.
You know, and that's one of those weird things. They tell you that drinking will raise your blood sugar. But yet, at the same time, it'll, in the short term, it'll knock it down.
Exactly. It peaks and then it drops. And if you don't have any protein in your system to stabilize the blood sugar, you're sunk. And also, you'll notice when you start sneezing, I think it does a number on cortisol, which is a natural antihistamine. So you start sneezing, you start getting the sniffly nose. I always had that after I had a night of beer drinking. But I love the
drink. Oh, well, wait. Now, hold on, Otto. Hold on. That's because they're, and particularly, it's true across the board, but as a beer aficionado, just because I can't doesn't mean I don't still love it. But particularly like with the Weissbier, the Bavarian Weissbier style.
Oh, yeah, right, the wheat beer.
Those are loaded with histamines.
Oh, okay. Well, that's it then.
And so, you know, you can if you channel your inner Bavarian and just pound down a bunch of Polana or something like that and wake up the next morning and you feel like somebody's turned you upside down and poured concrete in your sinuses. That's the beer.
Yeah. So that's why. Okay. Well, then I was wrong. But I always wondered why I was always sneezing the next day. And blowing my nose.
Beers are loaded with histamines, and I get what your dad was saying about, you know, eat what the ancients ate. But the funny thing is, you mentioned like cornmeal. One of the more interesting aspects is of the Columbian Exchange is the trip that corn rapidly made, you know, maize around the planet. You know, corn, potatoes, beans, squash.
Right.
It took up to the 18th century to convince white Europeans to eat tomatoes, because they were pretty sure the Indians were trying to poison them. Turns out they weren't. But but maize is probably the most fascinating vegetable, if you will, on the planet, because it's an example of human beings deliberately manipulating a plant species over the course of about 10,000 years. Can you imagine? First of all, we are a very young nation, so we can't imagine. But can you imagine the dedication of purpose that was required to just keep fucking it? Because it's a weed, okay? If you can still see it down in Central America and Southern Mexico. It's called teosinte, T-E-O-S-I-N-T-E. And it's just grass. It doesn't look anything like corn.
Really?
It doesn't look anything like corn.
Wow.
But somebody looked at that and said, this has potential.
Is the seed part edible, the stalk?
But it's scarcely worth mentioning. But somebody looked at it, you know.
Yeah, right.
But what's interesting is that when a food like that, you mentioned that it can wreck a culture. Same thing happened with the sweet potato in Asia. But
you know,
if it's used in its proper cultural context, you don't have that problem. There are no accounts from when the Spanish invaders came to Mexico, there are no accounts of like great big obese natives, and they were living on a corn intensive diet.
Oh wow! So their corn had less sugar, maybe, and had more better stuff. It was less fructose like corn, because now they use corn as a corn syrup and they add that to everything.
Oh, what you have to do to corn in order to get high fructose corn syrup shouldn't happen to a dog.
Right.
Or, you know, I don't know, a mangy rabid dog. We like dogs here.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm looking at every carton when I buy. I'm looking for sugars and I'm looking for carbs. And if it has too many carbs and some sugars, I don't buy it. I mean, that's the way I am. It's like I have to.
Well, they're so goddamn devious. I just happen to have a package here. You hear? I couldn't do that if I didn't really have a package. Mm-hmm. I have these filthy little habits, and recently they came out with all natural organic. Emphasis on the word organic. Doritos and. Cheetos white cheddar cheese puffs. And I will take any excuse to eat a Cheetos white cheddar cheese puff. And, and they're devastatingly good. But the problem is, about halfway down, there are these two words, organic maltodextrin. Maltodextrin is the solid form of high fructose corn syrup.
Okay.
And I don't care. So I don't care what you're. By the time you're done doing to corn what you have to do to it to come up with high fructose corn syrup and then dry it down to turn it into maltodextrin, that's probably the most ridiculous example of greenwashing I've ever seen. Organic maltodextrin. Because
the organic is, the organic doesn't mean anything. What you're eating is sugar.
Yeah.
You know, basically. And then in the sugar, but look at America. It's a diabetic nation, so we have a very high increase of type 2 diabetes. Well, I was type 2. My brother's type 2.
And at the risk of sounding like Amy Gordon in North Carolina, the one and understanding that association is not causation, I've always thought it fascinating that the at least under, based on the statistics that I've been able to look at, the massive upsurge in type 2 diabetes correlates with the replacement of plain old sugar in our foods, the replacement of sugar by high fructose corn syrup. Because here's the thing, as somebody who had to quit drinking, I'm sure you understand this, you know what mm-hmm. booze does in the liver. Well,
it causes cirrhosis.
It causes wreckage, you know, all kinds of different things.
Yeah, wreckage, yeah.
Well, as I understand it, high fructose corn syrup metabolizes through the liver, not through the gut.
Oh, really?
Ta-da!
So it hurts the liver, and liver disease, type 2 diabetes, is basically a liver disease.
Well, it's the liver plays a role, unless
it plays a role in it, yeah.
And so that's why I'm obsessive compulsive about it, except for, you know, cheesy poo.
Well, you know,
I won't buy stuff with high fructose corn syrup in it.
No, neither will I. But I'll never have a six pack gut anymore. You know, it's just. I mean, I've been struggling with a roly poly looking pear shaped gut all my since I was 28. But I had pneumonia in New York when I was 23 years old. And I was drinking, and I was doing lines of coke, and that was just a mess. You know,
well, now, yes, let's talk.
You know, I was young and stupid, you know. But I got a virus, so I got a flu bug, and then it got worse. I got pneumonia. I lost a huge amount of weight. But after that happened, that was such a shock to my system, I started gaining weight. I was like a skinny kid. And my brother once told me that my mom and dad were in a car accident. My mom was pregnant with me, like it was like the last trimester. Some guy walked in front of their old Rambler station wagon on Burnside, downtown Portland. Ran in front of them. He went right through the windshield. My mom flipped. The guy died. But I was in utero. And I'm wondering if that episode affected my growth. And because I was the skinniest kid in the family, my dad, he could not get me to gain weight. He gives me, like, ice cream and everything. But I was just, I think I was, like, born cursed. And I couldn't figure out, you know. And when my brother told me that, I said, my God, maybe that has something to do with the fact that I was so skinny. And my body was kind of, like, damaged, you know, from birth. But I don't know. That's just all speculation. But before I leave, I just want to say that my dad used to give people advice. He said about food. He said, you know, whatever you eat, make sure it's in a food group that rots, and whatever you and make sure that food group that you choose from is a food product that's no bigger than your head.
Don't eat food bigger than your head. You know, that's really good advice. And, you know, your dad was probably, well, he was obviously ahead of his time because several years ago, a guy named Michael Pollan, who wrote The Anatomy of Desire, among other things, fascinating book. He said, you know, take your grandmother's advice, don't eat anything your grandmother didn't cook with. Or if you can't, if you couldn't find it in your on your grandmother's shelf, don't eat it. And so that's why when I go looking for ice cream, for instance, I don't care how fancy the ice cream is or how beloved it is. The minute I see guar gum and locust bean gum and carrageenan, I'm done. Because my grandmother never made ice cream with locust bean gum, carrageenan, or guar gum. Now I'm sure they're natural products. They come from plants and whatever. But why would I want that when I can buy? And again, this is why we struggle because I'm talking about ice cream, Otto. But why would I want guar gum when I can buy ice cream that's just milk, cream, sugar, and eggs and vanilla? And then I can take it home and put honey strawberry jalapeno spread on it and just
go to town.
That sounds
good. But I know my problem. I just get a headache with sugar. I don't have a craving for it anymore, which is funny. But I do have a craving for chocolate. And chocolate has cannabinoids in it, so it helps you relax.
Aha.
But I take a little chocolate before I go to sleep at night. But somebody, I have a little honey, and if I have trouble sleeping, I'll take a teaspoon of honey, and that helps me fall asleep.
Well, you could do what the ancients did down in central Mexico. Chocolate was the beverage of royalty, but they had no milk. There was no milk. So we think of hot chocolate as being, milk, sugar, chocolate, hot. But they would there's this little gadget, and it's pure genius. It's a stick, and it's got rings attached to it. And you put it into your cup of chocolate, and you run the stick back and forth like that and make the rings spin, and it froths up the chocolate. And they made their chocolate with probably a little bit of maguey syrup. Or maguey sugar, and chocolate, and hot water, and they got the same buzz, if that's the right word, as you get from it. But I'm one of those that likes my chocolate bitter too.
I can't give up coffee. I love my coffee, and it's the closest thing. I had to quit smoking weed. It was just making me too lethargic. So the coffee, I bought a Folgers coffee machine, not a Folgers, I can't remember who makes it, but it's a little espresso machine. So I like it black, and I put a touch of cream in there. And cream doesn't have any carbs, so I just put a little in there. And then I get a nice buzz in the morning. I can do some reading, and then, have my lunch or whatever. But there's so many things I miss, but they were like things that I loved when I was a kid, but I couldn't figure out why. As a kid, I was up and down mood swings all the time. And you'll see that with kids. I see that when I was working as a custodian. They give these kids all this crap. Their glucose is too high after lunch. And they're like wired, They're running around the hallways. It's a discipline problem. It's usually more of a discipline problem after lunch because the foods they eat are shit.
Yeah. Well, I'm tickled pink that you worked up the courage to call and everything. You haven't fainted dead away or anything.
No.
The call.
I'm a kind of a Walter Mitty type. I don't do much calling, but your show is the best because you got the best chat room, and it's fun just listening to a voice. But I have to. I have to appreciate the voices you do of stupid people, and that's kind of why I'm also calling. That one woman you were doing about the vaccines, I was in stitches. You had her voice down right. But a friend of mine and I, we did a spoof of the right wing for cable access, and he had some of the funniest voices. But he did a piece, a video piece. I just videotaped it. He did the writing, and it was the title was "God Hates Buses." We want to make gasoline 25 cents a gallon, and also we kind of like the fact that forests. We want a forest without trees, so I could see over the stumps, I could see the view, and that sort of thing. So we take Republican viewpoints and we just make them even more right wing, and more perverted and screwed up. But our We had one of our sponsors we devised was Mobbish Cigarettes. He has this thing where if you buy...
Oh, I saw that. I watched that. You sent me that link. Yeah, that was hilarious.
Yeah. It's hilarious. I mean, he did that. That was like the best thing I did that came out of that cable access thing. He wrote all that. And I show that all the time to friends. I said, got to watch this. But he and I, we want to do another thing. We're going to get together again. And he's like a custodian like me. And it's kind of like I meet these people, working class people who are these closet intellectuals. He has a degree in history. I just have a general studies degree. I would have been a French major, but I decided I'd go in the film business. But I did a minor in German, and I really kind of cheated myself. I really should have gone a grad school and got my a master's degree in French literature.
Well, but, you know, the German you opened with was pretty impressive.
Oh, right. I've been studying German since a little kid. My folks made me study German when I was in first grade at public school. So I developed the ear for languages, but I fell in love with French. I said, well, why don't I go back and start studying German again? So I had 2 years of college German. So now I'm watching German television. It's so much fun. It's such a weird language. And once you get into it, they can do so many things in German you can't do in English. But it's a very, and people call it a guttural language. It's not. It's very defined, articulate language. And you hear, listen to somebody speak Hochdeutsch. It's really interesting. It's beautiful. I'm not quite.
Oh no, I'm quite fond of it.
Yeah, I'm fond of it too. But what always pissed me off is I tell people I'm studying German. They go, well, what are you, a Nazi? And go, fuck you. No, I'm not. Excuse me, I'm sorry. But I mean, I said it's. But think of all the great writers, the Jewish writers who wrote in German. And they go, oh, okay. And German's still spoken in Israel. There's a lot of refugees that went to Israel. They still speak German there, or Yiddish, which is a Germanic language.
Yeah.
But anyway, I just wanted to call. I really enjoy the show. I should probably free up the line, and it was I'll enjoy it. I want to make a commitment of $50, but I'll send you that tomorrow.
Okay. Shall we consider Catherine's challenge met then?
Yeah, sure. Let's make it. But I'm going to make the – I don't – my PayPal doesn't clear till tomorrow.
Right. No worries.
And okay. So you got $50.
Okay. Well, that's great because that meets Catherine's challenge. That means we're down to $180 to finish the night, which is freaking awesome.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so very kindly.
Hey, no problem.
All right, man.
Hey, great show. I do enjoy it. It's kind of like I've discovered you. I noticed you were following me on Twitter for the past 2 years. And I'm going, and you know, I should check him out. So I listened to you on YouTube. You upload your shows. And I was listening, oh, this is cool, you know. And I started laughing. Because you do these, I mean, you're from the South. Basically, West Virginia is kind of the South. Was West Virginia part of the Confederacy?
No. When we entered the, when we became a state on June 20th, 1863, we de facto entered as a Union state, but we were part of Virginia before then. So you've got a lot of you had a little private civil war going on among the hillbillies while everybody else was busy, you know, fighting the big one. And it carries down to this day because I know of one particular county where when I first got there, it was explained to me that the southern end of the county was pro-Union and the northern end of the county was pro-Southern, so naturally West Virginia, bass backwards, and people still chose which funeral homes they took their loved ones to based on which side great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpappy was in the war. And by war, they mean the Civil War.
Right, right. So Virginia, was, of course, Confederate. That's Lee's state.
Right. And Lincoln signed us into law as a state just to piss off Virginia.
Oh, sweet. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I didn't know that.
Well, and see, it makes sense. Okay, so this is radio, but you can do this. So hold your right hand in front of you. Look at the palm,
uh-huh.
Okay? Now form an obscene gesture. You know, the one with your middle finger. And the thumb is the thumb, you know, with the two fingers beside the middle finger kind of tucked down and the little finger tucked all the way down and the thumb extended. Well, West Virginia is the only state in the Union that forms an obscene gesture.
That's amazing. amazing. That's great. I got to look at the map, man.
And,
that's hilarious. And
so I think Abraham Lincoln knew that.
Oh, yeah. Well, Lincoln had a great sense of humor, too.
And so on June 20th, 1863, we became a state, and he was like, hey, Lee, fuck you.
Yeah, and also the Arlington Cemetery, they put a lot of the Union soldiers, the deceased Union soldiers in Arlington.
Oh, yeah, he never. And see, Lee was a deadbeat anyway, because he never had money of his own. His dad was... His dad was a bankrupt and brought shame on the family. So necessarily, he marries a descendant. Robert E. Lee marries a descendant of George Washington's wife, and that's where the money came from. That wasn't his house. That was her house. But he made himself at home, and you know enjoyed laying on 40 of the best on his slaves from time to time because he was such a great man. That's all sarcasm.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I don't know anything about Lee. I never really studied his. I did study the Civil War, but, I know Tecumseh Sherman shooted a number on Georgia, and I heard about the bow ties. They take a railroad iron, they heat it up, and they wrap it around an old oak tree or maple tree, and they, you know, it's like their way of saying, you know, fuck you. Excuse my friends. But
now you can use that French degree here on the program.
That's true. Hey, well, good talking to you.
Oh, it's been a blast, and I hope it will not be the last. And you know, jump in on Friday on the front porch sometime if you want to. You know, whatever.
Yeah. Okay. But this will be the last 50 for a while, so you'll have to excuse me. But I figure you deserve it.
Well, thank you. That's fine. That's fine. We've just got to. This is the downhill run to finishing out November, and everything after Friday is fundraising free radio. If we can just finish the week.
Well, I paid off all my credit card debts, and I've got extra cash flow. I'm renting out half my house upstairs. I'm converting it to a duplex, so I've got plenty of money now in my retirement. So I'm doing quite well, but. I do want to get back into production. My sister always bugged me, you're wasting your talents. I said, I know. But my next idea for a screenplay is Loser by Choice, Why I Became an Intellectual. And it's kind of like, why did I reject society? Because there's so much bullshit out there. But on that note, think about Karl Marx's concept of the commodity fetish. Wherever I go, I see the commodity fetish. Brand new cars. Like the other night, I saw this car for two GMC trucks. And they're huge. And, you know, we got this global warming going on. California's burning. I'm going, what the? You know, why would I want to buy an 8-cylinder truck that burns fuel? You know, I just get so depressed.
Well, you see, citizen, you're overthinking there is what you're doing. Yeah, you're supposed to just mindlessly consume, slap that Chinese yellow ribbon magnet on the tailgate of your great big Canyonero and toddle down the road and, you know, to hell with the future.
Exactly. And it's like that's what drives me nuts about Americans. They don't see that. People don't see this ideology. You know, you've got to watch this movie called They Live. You ever seen that where the guy puts the glasses on and the billboards say, And that's what America's becoming now. You have this corporate autocracy. You know, people complain about Trump. It could be Jim Baker in the White House for all I care. You know, it's like since Reagan, everything's been just gone downhill.
Well, yeah, and I know this is about the third time that you've tried to get free of the phone call, but let me just share one more thing from you.
Okay.
Because you said it could be Trump, it could be any other Republican or something like that, and nothing could be closer to the, nothing could be more true, because at the same time that we got exposed to the concept of forest raking this weekend, there was also the statement that Julius Geiser made about how it's a matter of bad management. Well, you know, I'm old enough that I can remember back in the Reign of Error when Dim Leader proposed the Healthy Forests Initiative, which was going to make the forests healthier by cutting them the hell down. And then we had the Clean Air Initiative, or the Healthy Clean Skies Initiative, that was going to make the air, the skies cleaner by pumping more filth into it. This is what Republicans do. And they do it because there's a dollar in it.
Right, right. Yeah, it's all based on profit. And that's what we have. And, you know, and it's like, look at China. They're like, they invest 100 years down the road. They're helping build the highways in Montenegro and off the Adriatic.
Well, what is it? The New Silk Road, 21st Century Silk Road. It's called Belt and Road, and it's one of the most fascinating, most ambitious engineering products in that the human mind has ever conceived.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And the Chinese will go anywhere for anything, and they don't much care about the politics so much as they do. Well, they're going to wind up being better capitalists than we are by a long shot.
Exactly, because they know how to invest, but it is an autocratic country. They're not necessarily communist anymore. I would say that I wouldn't know how to put them in positions in history. They're not Stalinist, but they are.
They've sort of jumped the ideological shark, and authoritarianism is always. It will always, I think, devolve toward fascism. And
right.
I think if you pay close attention to what the Chinese state is doing now, it's probably a hell of a lot closer to fascism than it is to communism. I mean, I read a story a couple of years back, like there's one village in China left that operates on Maoist principles. Yeah, one. So, yeah.
Yeah, and look at Stalin. He was not a communist. He was cynical, and he was this dictator. The Bolsheviks were too greedy, and they shut down the elections that Kerensky set up. Mensheviks actually won that election, and Lenin said, "Oh no, this isn't good. Let's call this dictatorship the proletariat, and the Bolsheviks are in power."
Well,
and that was it.
But you know what? You know what's hilarious about that? And I've mentioned this in the past. If you bother to read the Federalist Papers, talk about cynical.
Oh, that thing you talked about last week.
I mentioned last week that if you that in the Federalist Papers you can find it. I got to talk to Dr. Bill so he can give me the site so we can.
They talked about that today in Majority Report about that guy talking. You mentioned him. And go, I know this guy. Yeah. Bob Kincaid was talking about this.
But the idea that Madison said, listen, everybody's got, because see at the time that he and Hamilton hijacked the convention in Philadelphia and turned it into a constitutional convention, as a function of the way the Articles of Confederation were working, there were places where democracy was breaking out all over, and
yes.
It was scaring the bejesus out of the money. And so and the Federalist Papers are all designed toward convincing the states to ratify the Constitution, and there's a discussion where they say, listen, everybody's so fond of democracy, well, we're going to have some democracy, but hey, here's the funny part, whatever it is we come up with, no matter how undemocratic it is, we're going to call it democracy. And the rubes will swallow it.
Oh, totally cynical.
There's no difference between that and Lenin saying we're going to call it we'll call it communism.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I know. That's what I mean. And look what they did. But you got to remember, though, when the Bolsheviks came into power, they were under attack from everybody. The White Russians, the Cossacks, and then the United States got involved, and I think there was like this preliminary military campaign that landed somewhere outside of the district that was held by the Bolsheviks. It was a mess. Nobody wanted to go to war again after World War One. It was like, but they eventually beat everybody out. But they murdered so many people. Even Lenin had blood on his hands. Even Trotsky, you know. But I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with communism. I'm just saying that the revolutions, it perverts things, and that's why they're so scary, the revolution.
Well,
the French Revolution was a scary revolution.
Whether it's the Enlightenment thinkers or whether it's Marx, they're both trying to answer a basic question. What is it to be human? What is it to live in contact with other humans? And how can we take care of the most humans humanely without, you know, without everything falling to pieces?
All right.
And when Adam Smith is coming up with capitalism in what he considered to be one of his lesser works, and you read Adam Smith and, you know, he's hellaciously radical for his era. But he's looking he's looking back on 1,000 years of warfare on his little on his little island and over on the continent. And that ain't working.
Right.
And he's trying to, and so that's 1776. Well, it's not that much longer before Karl Marx is asking the same question and reaching a different answer, although not an answer that is entirely different.
Right.
Because Adam Smith's capitalism takes into account an idea of shared risk.
Right.
And also, that's the first thing that had to go with Adam Smith's capitalism, because there's not a CEO out there that's got the same amount of skin in the game as the guy who loses everything if he loses his job sweeping floors in the factory.
Right.
Because the guy at the top, if everything goes south, he's still going to have some sort of a compensation plan. Jesus, Agnes sent me a story the other day. I forget which bankrupt nightmare company it was, but they're, you know, lo and behold, they're asking the bankruptcy court to pretty please let them. Oh, I think it's Sears. It's Sears.
Right. That guy, the last CEO of Sears, built the company. He sold the company to somebody else, but it was his own. It was another company he owned, and then he rented the Sears buildings to Sears.
Right. Well, now in the bankruptcy filings, they're asking, please let us pay millions of dollars to our executives, who are executives of nothing, but they're going to get $1 million for it.
Yeah.
So.
And that's what's wrong. That's what's wrong. And Chomsky complained about Lenin and said Lenin was not pro workers' control of the factories, of their place of work. And that's what you need in a complete egalitarian society, that if you're working for something, you want to have a share of it. You just don't want to have a crappy wage. Like, I look at these Walmart employees, and I said, they're getting screwed over. They should be making $32 an hour. They're making 10 at least. You know?
Right, and the thing is, you could pay that $32 an hour, and it's not like the Walton family or the CEO of Walmart would have to start eating beans. I mean,
right, exactly.
It would be good for them if they did, but
they raise their arms and they go, oh, no, we're not going to put up with it. No. That means everybody's going to have to raise the rates, you know? And it's like
Well, what it boils down to is economic pouting.
What's that economic what?
Pouting. P-O-U-T-I-N-G.
Yeah.
Well, that's not fair. I mean, we're really, really rich, but we want to get even richer because we haven't figured out yet that they're not going to put a U-Haul behind our fucking hearse. So, if those people that are actually doing the work that makes us rich are making $30 an hour, well, that's unfair to us.
Well, you must know a lot about American labor strikes and whatnot. I think in the 1930s, GM workers went on strike, and the owner was a total jerk. He said, I'm not raising their wages. Screw you. And he just said, out of spite. You know, I can't remember what his name was. I watched a documentary on that, But anyway, I was going to say that, you know, I think the biggest problem with capitalism is that how arbitrary it is and how people can be born into wealth, like the Trump family, and other people are born into this poverty. And how do you break that disparity? And the economic disparity has been getting worse since Reagan. I think it even started under the Carter administration. Wages have constantly been stagnant. the last job I had was making $15.35 an hour. And that's not a lot of money, man. In Seattle, that's now the minimum wage. But everybody's screaming bloody murder.
My first job in the late 1970s, by the time I got my first, my first real live paycheck at the every 2 weeks job, the minimum wage had risen to $3.35 an hour.
Yeah.
The minimum wage. So that's 40 years ago. Okay. In 40 years, the minimum wage has risen from $3.35 an hour to not quite $10 an hour. In those same 40 years. The CEO compensation rate has gone orders of magnitude higher.
It's like 1,000%.
Right. Yeah.
I know. It's disgusting. You know, and then we have these people who fawn over these people and go, oh, you're such a great guy. Like this Bezos guy, you know, you're talking about that. You know, the other guy I can't stand, and I dropped my Facebook account, is
Zuckerberg.
Zuckerberg, yeah. I mean, he's just a nerd. But what's scary with him, he's politically apathetic. He has no colors. You know, you don't know if he's left or right wing. He's just a smart nerd. And that's the problem.
Well, I'm beginning to wonder how smart he is.
Well, I don't think he's that bright, because they knew all about the Russian crap that was going on in Facebook, and they didn't do anything about it.
Remember the Winklevoss twins swore up and down that he stole the whole idea for Facebook from them.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I didn't know.
And
that.
On the recommendation of the chat room, by the way, I should mention that last night Agnes and I watched The Founder. Sparky recommended that very highly, Michael Keaton. And that's the story. That's the story of Ray Kroc. And how he hoodooed McDonald's out from the people who actually invented it, and by the time screwed him royally. It's great. It's a wonderful film. I mean, God, it's nice to see Michael Keaton back doing the great work that he's capable of.
Oh, he's a good actor, isn't he?
Oh, he's fantastic. And
I like him a lot.
You watch this, and it starts out and it's interesting, and about halfway through, Agnes is looking at me because she's got this beautiful, beautiful heart, and she goes, "I don't like him anymore." I'm talking about Ray Kroc. Because it was just pure capitalism.
Oh, and, I know, I got critical theory, but just a few years ago, but I got into watching Christopher Hedges give talks, and he calls this corporate coup a slow-moving revolution for capitalism. He talks like cities like Cincinnati and Camden, New Jersey. These were towns that were robust, and now they're like shells of themselves, and that's what America's becoming. We're becoming like this third-world country with a bunch of dumb citizens. And you got all these rich people making thousands of millions of dollars exploiting foreign labor,
eventually the dystopian fantasies that we see in our science fiction movies like Blade Runner, will become self fulfilling prophecies, because somehow or another we're teaching ourselves to expect that. But I've kept you on and kept you on and kept you on, but this has been a fascinating conversation.
Well, thanks for letting... Yeah, it was a good conversation, but I wanted to get off the phone and let somebody else talk, because this is the stress line. I tried calling at the Friday afternoon, but I couldn't get a word in edgewise, so...
Well, I kept trying to... I don't know, it's like some sort of eldritch magic as to whether the stress line works or doesn't work. I mean, a couple of weeks ago, Scott couldn't hear the audio coming to him, but now you can.
Oh, really?
Nothing's changed,
Do you have any distortion in my voice? Is my phone okay?
No, iPhone
5.
No, you're good. You're good.
Okay. Well, cool. Hey, well, thanks, Bob.
Well, thank you, Otto. I appreciate it, and thanks for meeting Catherine's challenge. Thank you so very much.
I will, and I'll make sure you get that money tomorrow.
All right, thanks a bunch. Later.
Bye-bye.
From the chat room, that's our buddy Otto DeChat. It goes by other monikers as well, but I didn't know if I was at liberty to disclose, you know, real walking around names or anything. Some people like their anonymity. But that's that was a wonderful conversation. That's wonderful news that Catherine's challenge has been met. That means we've got an hour to find maybe 18 folks to kick in $10, or 10 folks to kick in $18, or one person to kick in $180. But if we can finish the week on Friday, and finish fundraising where we're supposed to be, we will trash Fitzwalker stand once again, and I think we will qualify for the Stephen New York's Go Bucks challenge, and we'll be good until December. So the more orderly fashion we use in catching up, the better off we are. If you want to help out, run over to headon.live, and the PayPal button is over there. If you want to become a subscriber, you know, just check mark the little box. That's cool. And I'm going to go right back to the phones in a second, but there are some things that there are some things that are sort of a necessity. By the way, in regard to the Founder movie, subject line, Ray Kroc, Ron and Raleigh writes, they gloss over the fact that Ray Kroc was a virulent racist, wouldn't allow black people to work the counter or own franchises. That's absolutely true. And God, how many years was it before they allowed a woman to work the front counter? He was a bigot all the way around, Ray Kroc, and of course it will come as no surprise to find out that he was a Republican, which is what makes it slightly, slightly satisfying to realize that he predeceased his wife, Joan, who was like 26 years younger than him. He broke up a marriage to marry her, his own and somebody else's, and got married himself in the middle, but that all got glossed over too. But when he passed on, good Republican that he is, and among other things, he despised minimum wage laws. But when he passed on and left his money to Joan then gave most of it away to ostensibly liberal causes. Wah-ha-ha-ha-ha. But anyway, with the whole Finland fiasco, every now and then you realize, or at least I do, that apparently we're just living in a series of... It turned out that Monty Python, the Monty Python troupe, were prophets and not just comedians. Kind of the same way that there's all kinds of prophetic stuff in The Simpsons these days. And maybe that's the genius of comedy, that it can look and sort of extrapolate out a ridiculous future, and we in turn will happily make it happen. And so with all the raking in Finland that we've been contemplating over the weekend, I think it would be simply criminal not to run this.
Finland, 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 the country where I want to be, pony trekking or camping, or just watching TV. Finland, 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 it's the country for me. You're so near to Russia, so far from Japan, quite a long way from Cairo, lots of miles from Vietnam. Finland, 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 the country where I want to be, eating breakfast or dinner, or snack lunch in the hall. Finland, 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 Finland has it all. You're so sadly neglected and often ignored, a poor second to Belgium when going abroad. Finland, 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 the country where I quite want to be. Your mountains so lofty, your treetops so tall. Finland, 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 Finland has it all.
Oh, together, Finland Files!
Finland, 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 the country where I quite want to be. Your mountains so lofty, your treetops so tall. Finland, 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 Finland has it all.
You understand. This will probably keep that keep this evening's program from being posted at YouTube, but what the hell. Sometimes you just have to obey the comedic gods. I mean, is there anybody? I mean, just take a minute. Is there anybody who ever giggled at that song over the course of the years? And thought, hey, in the waning years of the second decade of the 21st century, an American president will claim that forest fires can be prevented by raking the forests because the president of Finland, 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 the country where I want to be, told him that's how they keep their forests from burning. Really? Because if there is somebody out there who thought that, then I think we should probably elevate that person to some sort of temporary dictatorial monarchy of the nation just long enough to figure out what the heck's going on. See what I did there? And straighten things up. Maybe it means that Michael Palin needs to be temporary president for life or something. I mean, he's older now, but he's probably sharp enough. So with $180 to raise to finish the evening, let's run back over to the Skype line this time and check in with Scott. Hey, Scott.
Hey, Bob. How are you?
You know, Finland.
Finland, yes. I've been out of the loop for some days now, and I don't know what's going on. My sleeping patterns
are you
gone.
Okay? Are you okay?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm, physically and psychologically fine.
You didn't have you didn't have the 24-hour Ebola or anything, did you?
No. There's something about the spring forward, fall back deal that, for reasons that I can't explain, it throws a wrench into my sleeping patterns. And I am, it's, you know, normally when I would be awake and around and doing stuff, I am dead to the world. And I get up and it's like early evening. So I have got to, focus and get back on to some sort of rational sleeping schedule. Cause I've been completely out of the loop horn-wise, I don't know, at least for the past week almost. So I need to brush up on my proper sleep skills. And it'll happen again in the spring for the first couple of weeks after the time change.
Well, I'm glad I'm not alone in that, Scott, because as I said, the older I get, the more this simple one-hour time change screws with me.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, I don't know whether it has to do with the sun going down earlier, darkness settling in at 5:15 in the afternoon or whatever. And you're far north enough, I guess, that it stays later there, or stays lighter there, like in the summer.
That's at the very height of it, there'll be some light twinkling yet. There'll be a little bit of light in the sky, say, 9:30.
Yeah.
To give you an proper placement, West Virginia is on the 38th parallel.
Well, see, I don't know nothing about no parallels.
You know, Korea.
But I don't know. Geography was not my strong suit. And I blame Sister Carol Dorothea in the fifth grade. And I'll go on record. That woman had no business being around children. She was my fifth grade geography teacher. And to this day.
Hated children, did she?
She didn't hate children, but she was not well suited. Let's put it that way. She should have been in some other field of endeavor. And a couple of nuns had that issue. Yet there were other nuns who were wonderful with kids. We had a good number of civilian teachers in my Catholic grade school experience. And you were talking about the Chinese earlier with Otto. My sixth grade social studies teacher, Miss Kramer, one of the finest teachers I ever had, she said, and this was back in the middle 60s, you know, 66 or so, that by the end of the world, whenever it came, the Chinese would be running the world. And back then, you know, they were, you know, no one could even envision anything like that happening, you know, with the U.S. being the top dog on the global scale, the global picture. But damn. And I blame Nixon for that, you know, as a PR thing, going to China and opening up relations with the Chinese. Jesus, you know. And a half hour later, you want to open them up again. So where did it get us? But that's not why I called.
No, never is.
No. You know, I'm all for raking our forest floors, you know, being inspired by Finland. But why don't we just go whole hog with this thing? Why don't we adopt their universal health care and education systems and their gun control laws? If we're going to emulate Finland, let's just do it. Let's, you know, do it till we're satisfied.
Yeah, let's go all the way and start paying our teachers what physicians get paid here, because they do that in Finland.
Yeah, and like have children coming out of their education experience, actually being educated. You know, I doubt that from Trump on down, you know, you pick any 15 red ball cap Chinese imported red ball cap wearing morons, just pick them at random, throw darts at a map, you know, and then go to those places, knock on the doors, gather them together, hand them an unmarked map, and I'll bet you not one of them can show you where Finland is on the goddamn map of the world.
Oh, I wouldn't take the bet.
No, I would. I mean, but I don't know. Don't get me started on these clowns. And you were talking about humor earlier. I'm flipping through my my news Wagga Wagga here on my computer. Where did it go? Wait a minute. I just had it here. Oh, yeah. In the New York Times an hour ago, get this, no comedy at the next White House Correspondents' Dinner.
No, that was, yeah, I mentioned that. I mentioned that at the toward the front end of the program. And
I was late getting to the party today.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm glad you brought it up, because we can delve further into it. What a capitulation!
Well, doesn't it make sense that in the state of things being as they are in the White House, and the correspondence being trashed or banned, okay, wouldn't it make sense? Humor, and I've always said that with humor, you can get serious points across in a non-threatening way.
Well, that's the last
thing you want to get rid of.
In an autocratic society, humor and music are about the only ways that you can do it.
I know.
Of course, you know, because I love the idea of being a little bit, subversive. I'd love it. We're going to have Ron Chernow.
Yeah.
And then at the last minute at the nerd prom, say, maybe have David Letterman walk out and say, gee, folks, Ron caught the infotego, so I'm just going to do some juggling and stuff for the next hour or 30 minutes or something, and And then just eviscerate Trump for a half an hour.
Yeah. Yeah. Or Colbert.
Yeah, but Colbert did it during the Reign of Error. I don't think Letterman ever got tapped to do it.
Probably not. I don't know about you, but the year that Letterman did the Oscars, I loved it. It was just subversive and dysfunctional enough to where it was entertaining. And I think it had been going through a bit of a stretch where the Oscars were not quite as enjoyable.
But also from the perspective of, gosh, can't we find anybody but some old white guy? Here's one that would make his hair fall out. You know, the one for the White House Correspondents Association dinner.
Yeah, okay.
You know, the one 72-foot long hair that they have to do up into his Trump do every day. Wanda Sykes.
Oh.
Ron Chernow's stuck in, where's he stuck? Yeah, Saskatchewan. He had a lecture up there. He couldn't make it. So, Wanda, we saw Wanda out on the sidewalk and asked her if he could just come in and talk a little bit.
Enlighten us. Yes, that would be fun. Now, does the president attend? Yeah, the president usually attend. A president usually will attend.
Well, when it's anybody but Trump.
Yeah. Well, he's missing the.
He goes and sulks. He goes and sulks at a golf course.
He's skipping the Kennedy Center honors this time around.
They always skip them, don't they?
Second time in a row.
Yeah.
I think in memory, the only time a president had ever skipped them. What year was that and which president? There was one year when the president had to skip because there was something of global importance going on. Unless I'm misremembering.
I don't know. Obama showed up the same night we were busy killing bin Laden.
Yeah. So multitasking is possible. He just doesn't want to be anywhere.
Well, the last time he showed up for one, he got his ass handed to him by Barack Obama.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's...
And I think there's a compelling argument to be made that the reason we have Donald Trump as president is because of that night.
Yeah, I've heard that. So I don't know. I don't guess they will rethink the notion. I'm sure Ron Chernow is a great writer and all that, but for that venue and these times, we need somebody who is not as, you know.
I can't imagine that at a party full of drunk millionaires, that Ron Chernow is going to just set the room on fire.
No. No, he's got all the.
I also nominate Eliza Schlesinger.
Now, who is that?
Oh, if you haven't watched her stuff, you got to watch her stuff. It's all over Netflix. Just Eliza Schlesinger, and apparently she was mentored at least to a certain extent by Bobcat Goldthwait.
Oh, okay. Well, she'll be good then.
Oh,
he's pretty bizarre.
No, it's one of her specials was directed by him. And you can kind of see you can see some of his mannerisms and what, but she is her own woman entirely. And I absolutely,
Listen, you mentioned The Founder, the movie about Ray Kroc.
Yeah.
And I did see that when it first launched, I guess, what was that, Netflix or
yeah,
Amazon?
Netflix.
Well, it was one of them. And liked it, and I'll need to rewatch it because some of those movies you get distracted, and I think that may have happened. But what I remember of it was quite good. But you're right about Joan Kroc, being younger and also inheriting all the money. And we've had a number of institutions here in San Diego that have benefited from her largesse. Ray Kroc at one time had an ownership position with the San Diego Padres baseball.
Yes, he did.
Organization. So, you know, she still lives around here, I think, and has, she gave, I don't know how many millions of dollars to the local PBS and NPR outfit, K KPBS TV and FM several years ago, and they built studios and named the studios and the broadcast complex for her, which was nice. But she's also, I forget the other organizations, but she's been quite the responsible, wealthy person around here, and we could use more of that. But another TV viewing tip is on YouTube, and it's an oldie. Do you remember the McNeil Lehrer report?
Oh, yes.
Well, after McNeil retired from the nightly, you know, McNeil Lehrer report, and then Jim Lehrer did it a number of years on his own, he launched into a couple of documentary programs, and one of them in the mid-'80s was called The Story of English. And it was like
I love that series.
Well, it's on Netflix, apparently for free, all nine parts. And I remember watching it, and I happened upon it over the weekend or leading into the weekend. So I started watching it again. And it is a joy to learn something about one's mother tongue.
Oh, it's you know what? Just while we're sitting here mentioning things that, I would dearly love it if it was, and maybe it's out there. Somebody will probably send me an email. I would love to sit down and watch all over again online Bill Moyers and with Joseph Campbell and The Power of Myth.
Oh, it's on either Netflix or Amazon.
Is it really?
So, yes, it's been on there a month or so. And I watched the first few episodes.
Because it's based on The Hero with a Thousand Faces.
Oh, it's amazing. It's amazing to listen to the insights that Campbell was putting forth. And see, that's the greatness of television when it's done responsibly and intelligently. What passes for good TV in this day and age? Well, first of all, it's non-existent for the most part. All right. But you know, and you get snatches of it on like PBS or sometimes HBO will have a very good documentary or insightful program. And they used to be part of the weekly lineup on ABC, NBC, and CBS once upon a time. But those days, you know, the commitment to news and the news product has gone to hell on the networks. And, you know, I'm old enough to remember, like one night a week for an hour, they would delve into a subject, and you'd have David Brinkley as the anchor, or Howard K. Smith over on ABC, or Cronkite or one of them on CBS. And I'm sure they didn't do well in the ratings, but they had an audience, and the networks had a commitment to doing that type of programming. Hell, I remember Arts and Entertainment, A&E, back when it was Arts and Entertainment.
I remember A&E when it was the All Hitler Network.
Well, that's what it is now. You don't need much of a memory. But I don't know. I don't mean to be all curmudgeon-y.
Well, a little breaking news courtesy of the Sydney Morning Herald.
Okay.
You might not want to make a whole lot of long-range plans.
Oh, no.
With the kind indulgence of Robert in Australia, who just wrote in regard to I had responses in regard to your statement about the time change. Hung Like Jesus said, for me, it's a combination of the seasonal change and the time change. I'm sleepy all day every day until sometime after Thanksgiving. Yeah, and just kind of squirreled. Robert in Australia said, adjust the clock 30 minutes. I wish they'd just adjust the clock 30 minutes and leave it there year-round. There would be wreckage after that. But with Robert's kind indulgence, I will use my terrible Australian accent. And read the following headline: super powerful interstellar ticking time bomb found not far from Earth. Australian astronomers say they've spotted a super powerful star that could explode at any moment in one of the most powerful detonations since the Big Bang. And this ticking time bomb is not far from Earth. In a pad of the Milky Way, 8,000-odd light-years away, two stars, each about 30 times bigger than our sun, are circling around each other. Their combined gravity is making each star spin on its axis at incredible speeds. It's a final dance macabre before the largest star in the system explodes. Around them, a vast interstellar dust cloud is whirling at extreme speed, whipped into motion by the star's spin. If a planet was nearby, its inhabitants might look to the sky to see a vast red cloud hurtling across it and two huge stars glowing malevolently within. Astronomers have named the system Apep, after the Egyptian god of chaos. If that burst was to hit Earth, half our atmosphere would dissolve in an instant. Some researchers even believe one of these gamma ray bursts may have been responsible for the death of the dinosaurs. So, that having been said, and yes, Ron and Raleigh, that was old Crocodile Kincaid. I know you've wanted to hear from him for a while. Cousin Croc. Ray Croc, Joan Croc, Cousin Croc. See how it all comes together, Scott?
It works like a Swiss watch.
Yeah.
Well, that's one more thing for us to...
I think we need to put up some satellites so that we can rake space.
Yeah. Well, let me close on two positive things.
Yes.
And free it up for somebody else to jump in. First of all, happy 82nd birthday today to my favorite talk show host, even more favorite than Johnny Carson, Richard Cavett, is 82 today.
Oh, my goodness.
And I've loved him with a passion.
The most erudite man ever to host a talk show.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and a lot of his stuff is on YouTube. And you talk about the art of conversation, about weighty stuff and even lightweight stuff, but with some wit and intelligence attached to it. There was none better than Cavett when it came to that.
If his entire career had consisted of nothing but his relationship with Groucho Marx,
mm-hmm.
it would have been worth it.
Yeah. Yeah. And one last thing for those keeping track here. What are we now, 2 weeks out from the election, the midterms?
Tomorrow, yes.
Okay, according to the AP, as told by the New York Times website, 37 seats gained by the Democrats, giving them a 232-199 majority, and there are still three or four more seats left to be fully counted. And I'm astounded at my own self, having just pulled the number out of thin air a couple of weeks ago. And I said, well, my fearless forecast after weighing things and looking into my crystal crock pot, I think 37 will be the number that we're looking for in the midterm.
You know, you really should have dropped a fin over at Harris in Reno.
I probably should have. And these other three or four, I think some of them are in California. Well, you heard about Orange County, didn't you?
Oh yes, of course.
There's no.
Yeah, who was the one never Trump Republican who tweeted, "Well, congratulations, GOP, you lost Reagan country."
Yeah, yeah, and before that, it was Nixon country. And who would have thought that that was possible? You know, I'm just, you know, maybe that's why my sleeping has been so interesting lately. After the midterms, I'm sleeping better. I'm not waking up in a cold sweat. You know, and
yeah, but I am the little ray of fucking sunshine, Scott. So
well, look, I would not expect anything other than that. Go on.
Well, no, I mean it's just I'm sitting here watching the Democratic scab pulling brigade.
Oh no!
With their tweezers nice and sharp and oiled, picking 2016 scabs, And you know, you got a bunch of, you know, what's the hashtag, five white guys, who've declared some sort of fucking fatwa against Nancy Pelosi because they ran on that. And who, really, honest to God, who of these noobs who are coming in think they actually got elected because they ran around the hustings shitting on Nancy Pelosi? Really? You think that's what got you in?
Well, and see, the thing is, it's like, and I'm no great fan of Nancy Pelosi, but there is something to be said for tenacity and experience and fundraising.
Well, can we get a little cowbell for simple fucking competency?
Well, yeah.
Being good at your job.
And you know, I would like to see a someone, you know, under 60 being Speaker of the House.
And you know what? That's Nancy Pelosi's plan. She's talking. I don't want to do this forever. She's talking.
Well, no.
You know, she's talking about bringing in new blood, and teaching people how to be as good at it as she has been, and she has been good at it. The fact, it drives me batshit, Scott, that you've got so many people out there who think that history began with them, and don't remember the fact that she sat there and, because I remember when George Bush, you know, sort of allegedly won in 2004, and he said, well, it's my second term, and I got me some political capital, and I'm going to spend it now, and we're going to piratize the Social Security, because it's just a goddamn filing cabinet with a bunch of useless IOUs in Parkersburg, West Virginia. I've been there. I didn't see them.
Yeah.
And she said, oh, fuck no, and stopped him cold. And then when we had the 1 year with Barack Obama in office, she sent over bill after bill after bill after bill after bill after bill, and they all died in the Senate because Mitch McConnell. We had this little palace coup in her office a week or so ago with a bunch of young progressives with whom I have no fight, and with whom I largely agree, saying, you know, we want a real commitment to climate change, and we want the Green New Deal, goddammit. When, if they'd been paying attention about a week or so earlier, she said she was looking to do the same thing that she did back when she formed a select committee when she was majority leader and came up with the Waxman-Markey bill.
Well, and it makes me think that
you got a bunch of right-wingish Democratic members of the House, mostly guys, your Tim Ryans and your Seth Moultons, who are running around, oh, is she too liberal?
Well, two things about Nancy Pelosi. First of all, she is she's like an engine or a pair of jeans or a pair of boots. She's well broken in. She's pre-inoculated against anything that they could possibly throw at her. So she's got that going for her. But the other thing is, and it makes me think that a lot of these younger folks do not, and I hate to get that way, but let's face it, I am a little bit older than some of these younger folks. That's why I call them younger folks, because I'm older than them.
Get off my clouds!
But the thing is, they don't seem to know their history. It seems to me that after Tip O'Neill, we had a couple of Democratic speakers or honchos. I remember the house banking thing. I remember a number of little incidents that did not leave the Democrats in a very positive light. Now, whether that was GOP, you know, name calling and rat fucking, there may have been some of that. But the thing about it is, you know, you want somebody who can get stuff accomplished. And who knows? I mean, she's still up against, you know, a McConnell-run Senate. We didn't take the Senate, but we sure as hell took the House. And we can get some stuff done if we focus and look at the big picture and the future. You know, that is my fear, my little fear in the back of my mind, is that we will miss the big picture. We will miss the appropriate goals and steps and fuck this up. And I don't want to see us fuck this up because, you know, Democratic control of the House is key. I mean, if we had not won the House of Representatives, control of the House of Representatives, and you said it, and I said it, and the caller said it, and everybody said it, we would have been screwed. And maybe we still are screwed, but at least there's something working in our behalf, on our behalf. I don't mean to be Pollyanna-ish, but I'll take my happiness.
Well, no, I mean, this is Casey Stengel with the 1961 Mets standing there in the dugout screaming at the bench, does anyone here know how to play this game?
Well, yeah. Yeah. And people say, well, there wasn't a blue wave. Well, let's look at it. The Republicans were placed on the Senate side to just kick ass and not even bother taking names. And what did they end up doing? When all is said and done, I don't know how many Senate races are yet to be decided. I don't think any. But when all is said and done, they'll still have one. Okay, which one?
Mississippi.
Oh, that's right.
Where the member of the Klan Ladies Auxiliary is apparently trying to get herself elected to her own term.
Well, there's a lot of black folks in Mississippi, and a lot of smart white folks too.
Yeah, and a lot of white folks who don't want the black folks to do any of that confounded voting.
Yeah, I don't know. How is Mississippi compared to, say, Florida or Georgia when it comes to disenfranchisement? Weren't there a lot of steps taken to
Mississippi's the home office?
Well, I know. That was kind of a rhetorical question. But we're watching for it down there. And the timeline is, because there's a runoff, I think it's like the 27th or something. Of November.
And her numbers are plummeting.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Because not only did she say that she would she would happily attend a lynching.
Yeah.
Because as I pointed out last week, the term is not I'd go to a public hanging. It's I would go to a lynching.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what the old racist phrase is.
Well, yeah, if you're going for good old Southern hateful authenticity,
and she followed that up by saying, "Well, you know, we might need a little more voter suppression because I hear some of them liberals want to vote." Ha 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 ha
ha. Well, I will never live in Florida.
I mean, she looked.
Chances are, I'll never live in Georgia, and chances are most certainly that I will never live in Mississippi.
On the one hand, she looks, I forget who it was that pointed out, she looks like Swoozy Kurtz's evil twin. for the film buffs out there.
Yeah.
Secondly, Jesus, I mean, who says that? I mean, we know who says that, but.
Yeah.
She's rumor has it that in the rumblings and mumblings, it's she's not ne ute hitebre if you own ne what I ain't me.
Well, Bob, she probably thought that freight train passing by was louder than it was, but them microphones weren't too sensitive.
I paid a lot for that goddamn freight train.
She's gonna
talk about the lynching now. Cue the freight train.
Yeah, and the Warner Brothers cartoon music powerhouse. If you don't remember the name, look for it on YouTube. It's that industrial music from the 30s and 40s. But anyway, let me finish my point. So we've got roughly one more Senate seat to be decided. But when all is said and done, the Republicans will have a majority of two.
Yep.
Isn't that pretty much what we'll end up with if things go well?
Well, if we win in Mississippi, and that's an uphill fight, it's either going to be 53-47 or 52-48.
Yeah. Well, what was it before? It was 52-48, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, that to me is indicative of something going on, because we won the House, okay? We've won governorships this time around. We've done well in places where we probably had no right to expect to do well. And on the Senate side, the Republicans had the most advantageous map that they've had in recent years, and they didn't quite get it done in a way that they were hoping and expecting to. And I think that says something about the mindset and the attitude of the nation. And I know that we go back and forth about, you know, is there sunshine or is it just opportunities for more rain? And that's okay. That's part of the conversation. That's what we do. But I am happy and comforted and sleeping better. And, you know, in due course, people get to work. Get to work and let your representatives know and let your senators know that now that the dust has settled and in January when they're all seated in their new spots, let them know that you're keeping track of things and give them marching orders. They tend to respond if you let them know that their future viability in office may be at stake if they're not paying heed to what the people want. But God knows the Republicans do it. So why shouldn't we? Let's win. Doesn't anybody know how to play baseball?
Yeah, by the way, and if we have a correction, Lee reminds me, right. The Mets were created in 1962. It was the 62 Mets, not the 61 Mets. I regret the error.
Okay,
but
well.
Does anyone know how to play this game? Remains the applicable phrase.
Well, anyway, there is plenty yet to do, and I don't even want to go to 2020, because there's plenty of stuff to occupy us now. And if we take care of the stuff presently before us with an eye to the future and then ramp that up as it becomes appropriate, we will do fine. But we can't rest on our victories. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, look, I agree. And the Senate's going to be what the Senate is. And I think depending on what the investigations show and when the there's going to be a blizzard in Washington, D.C., but it's going to be the kind where some asshat from Oklahoma can't show up with a snowball in the well of the Senate because it's going to be a blizzard of subpoenas.
Mm-hmm.
And when those things start flying in January, it's kind of like what I said about the Finland song. You know, who could have ever imagined? Well, who could imagine it? No, there's not going to be, we're not going to get 67 senators to vote to remove him from office.
No.
But the amount of information that is developed may be sufficient to at least find three Republicans. Jesus, this is the part where they're going, oh, who's the Pollyanna now? Find three Republicans who will say, no, he's simply got to be stopped in his tracks. He cannot go any further. Because I think that kind of information is out there, Scott. By the way, Lee wants me to tell you, please tell Scott, stop telling us how old to be.
Well, you know, when you get to be as decrepit as I am, you've earned it. You know, at least every other day or every third day to say, you kids, get off my cloud. But there was a piece on one of the online news services the other day that I posted on my Facebook about their speculation that Pence is making his move. He's sniffing around and finding blood in the water, or blood soon to be in the water, vis-a-vis Trump. You know.
Well, he went to the Asia for the ASEAN meeting, ASEAN. And he certainly did put on a butch performance there.
Was mother with him?
I don't know. I love that story that Trump's running around now. Do you think I can trust Mike Pence? So, you know, every opportunity, people should be tweeting at him, you know, you can't trust Mike Pence.
There you go.
You know, he's just waiting to sign the 25th Amendment letter. In fact, I tweeted that at Trump earlier today. You know, he's just waiting to sign the 25th Amendment letter.
And say whatever you will about Nancy Pelosi, getting back to her for just a moment. But don't you know that the Republicans and the conservatives and the Nazis and the asshats are just shitting themselves from Trump on down that, you know, the possibility that she will be speaker again? Oh, they are gnawing on legs of furniture over this.
Well, they are. And that's why I kind of hate to see us shitting in our nest the way we are. But I want to reemphasize the whole concept of dream big. I'm looking at the 2020 Senate map.
Yeah.
And here's just a few, and the time to start campaigning against these assholes is 2 weeks ago. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So Susan Collins, Shelley Moore Capito, Lamar the Platt Avenger Alexander, some asshole in Georgia, some asshole in North Carolina, Lindsey Graham, John Cornhole in Texas, Mitch McConnell is up in 20.
Oh, that would be so wonderful to get rid of him.
There's an Arizona senator we could take. And all we have to defend are senators in Oregon, New Mexico, Minnesota, Illinois, Michigan, New Jersey, New Hampshire, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Alabama.
So, in other words, the map is flipped as in terms of advantage.
Yeah, and that's and so, you know, yeah, dream damn big. As I told John Bridavo last week, I would love to see Beto. I'm not so sure I want him to run for president, but I would damn sure love to see him beat John Cornhole.
Oh yeah,
in Texas.
I mean, it was sad to me that, but you certainly knew that he ran against Cruz, Eduardo.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
and you know, if you want a picture of blatant hypocrisy, the blatant hypocrisy of Rafaelito Eduardo Cruz, the anointed booger-eating future king of America. Somebody asked him a question the other day, something like, "What about the immigrant caravan?" or something negative that he said about Beto, and he said, "Ah, the election's over."
No.
So it was in other words, it was bullshit all along.
Well, it was nice. I'm sorry that he won, but it was nice to see him work for it. Because if he had done what so many Republicans tend to do sometimes and just sloughed it off and took it all for granted, I think there may have been a different outcome. And he had, oh, man, he had special interests and money and, you know, in conservative PACs and God knows who else.
Well, I mean, just to give you a taste of some of the other names, Tom Cotton, that freaking genius in Arkansas, he's a one-termer, and we could maybe get shed of him in Arkansas. How about having Stacey Abrams run against Dave Perdue? He's a one-termer.
Oh, in Georgia, yeah. Wasn't he kin to another Purdue down there?
I'm not sure. Let's see. Bill Cassidy is a one-term incumbent in Louisiana. Susan Collins, pay her back.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Mississippi's going to be up again. Who else do I despise? Wouldn't it be lovely to find a viable Democratic candidate to challenge a different kind of Republican, Ben Sasse, in Nebraska?
Yeah, that guy gives me the willies, as it were. Him and Jeff Flake, Jesus. What was his latest? You know, you talk about Jeff. How do you describe a Jeff Flake threat to do something? Hollow.
Yeah.
There is no chewy center to a Jeff Flake threat. But he said that he will, and if they don't put to a vote something in the Senate to protect.
The protection of Mueller, that he will.
Yeah. And did you see? Well, you not sorry. You don't have over the air TV there. I was watching Lindsay on Face the Nation the other morning, and oh dear God, he wants to do poor Lindsay. He wants to do right. He wants to protect the Mueller investigation because it's going to get so messy for the GOP.
Yes, but he's not sure if it's going to find its way to him because, you know, he's got a pocket full of that Russian money.
Yeah, and it's just, it's in some ways it's entertaining to watch him weasel and squirm.
Oh, and by the way, I have an update for you.
Clarity
lets us know New Mexico's 2nd District went Democratic. It's 38 now.
Good. I'm glad to see it. I'm glad to be wrong in my count and to the good of us, you know?
Yeah.
And so that would make it, what, two more? Did I say three or four or two or three more seats in the House to be decided?
I'm not sure, but...
I don't know. I'm just gratified that we did what we needed to do in the places we needed to do it, because that's always going to be the key.
But there is more work to be done.
Yeah, yeah. Not the least of which is Scotch guarding all the furniture and the drapes and everything around Thanksgiving tables around the country. Because you know there will be, if not gunshots, food fights, which makes me laugh that I don't live anywhere near my relatives, especially my brother down in Florida.
Well, there might be gunplay involved, so.
There could be anything this time around, because you know that somebody is going to say something, and you know somebody's going to take it a different way, and the cranberries and the hazelnuts and the celery with cream cheese in the center of it, it's going to be flying.
You mean the pimento cheese, cream cheese with the celery? I love that.
Oh, yeah. My mom used to make a plate, like a little appetizer plate with all those
And the sweet pickles and the black olives.
Oh, dear God. Yes. That's one thing I do miss about old-style Thanksgiving. But, see, there's not a lot of old-style Thanksgivings now. It's like an episode of Maury or Jerry Springer around the old family table.
Well, I guess the folks at the Splendid Table on NPR are going to have a Thanksgiving crisis lineup.
Oh, no.
Kid you not, live, you know, call in with your, we'll be here, call in with your Thanksgiving problems, and we'll get through this.
And don't mix it up with the Butterball number, because they can't help you with your family dynamics.
And if it's not a Butterball, fuck you, buddy.
My Uncle Bubba's pop-up timer done sprung. What do I do? Oh, the safety on his gun? Ooh. Well, anyway, I said I was going to go. But
you should have known better.
I know. But I'm telling you, let's enjoy the holidays as we can, okay, and not, you know, bruise one another too badly.
God bless us, everyone.
But let's, you know, make as our resolution for 2019, and who thought we'd ever get to this number on the calendar? I surely didn't. you know, that we've got good stuff ahead if we play smart and just focus and do what we did this last time around. That's
just kind of,
but only
just kind of
do more of it,
you know, just kind of walk deliberately, keep your head down, eyes on the ground. And when you see the tines of that rake, because we're back to the rakes again, when you see the tines of the rake poking up, don't step on the rake.
Yeah.
Bang! Don't do that.
Well, I think Trump has done that a fair number of times. That was his one responsibility as a youngster, was to rake the front and back 40 of the Trump homestead. And I believe Mr. Trump stepped on that rake more than a few times.
Oh, geez. You know that photo that's become a meme out there of Trump standing and screaming at the little kid pushing the lawnmower? You've seen it, I know.
Yeah.
This weekend, there it is again, and it's captioned, "Do you know anything about rakes?"
Well, there's one I saw this morning, Smokey Bear decked Trump.
It's climate change, dumbass.
Good Lord. I love it for the entertainment value, but I also love it, especially in the wake of the midterms, that it's nice to show that we can get it right. Because this could have ended so differently. It really could have.
Oh, yeah.
And you were, I know it was a long haul getting, you know, because you are, it's not just your bit about the little ray of fucking sunshine. It's the fact that you see clearly things that some of us more, you know, where with our rose-colored spectacles don't.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, okay, so
you see the big picture.
Thank you, Scott. And let me, toward that end, let me just put something out there for our consideration.
All right.
You know, the hashtag's been going around on Twitter, Green New Deal, a concept with which I largely agree. But in that conversation, I have never seen anybody bring up mountaintop removal. And so, you know, well, if it would be lovely if this community would tweet, you know, hey, when we're talking about hashtag Green New Deal, comma, let's not forget we've already got an important piece of Green New Deal legislation in the Congress, comma, H.R. 786, comma, the Appalachian Communities Health Emergency Act, period. Because I'll bet you 99% of those Green New Deal the folks tweeting about the Green New Deal have no idea, no earthly idea that the AIC Act, one of the most important pieces of environmental legislation that's been introduced in the last, you know, 8 years, even exists.
And what happens if it's not attended to and voted on this time around? Do they have to start completely?
Oh, it'll have to be reintroduced in the next Congress. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
But the first hurdle is making them aware of it.
Yeah.
Because I can't tell you how many environmentalists that I've talked to, and I've mentioned the AIC Act, and they look at me like a cow looking at a new gate.
Well, what is this Green New Deal, a thumbnail of that? What does that entail?
For all intents and purposes, it's sort of an all-hands-on-deck approach to taking climate change seriously. I mean, that's really the thimbleful version.
Well, I guess that in the grand scheme of things, that would be a very important thing to get handled. But where does it fit in everything else that needs to be done? Because that's the other thing that we're going to come up against, is the prioritization of tasks. That many times that will be a pass-fail sort of thing. You can have good notions and things and momentum going in, but if you don't prioritize your work, you don't get quite the punch that you would have otherwise gotten, if that makes sense. But yeah, I would say the future of life on the planet is a high consideration.
Okay, here's the pressy on the Green New Deal.
All right.
100% of national power generation from renewable sources. Building a national
building
a national energy efficient smart grid. Upgrading every residential industrial building for state of the art energy efficiency, comfort and safety. Decarbonizing the manufacturing, agricultural and other industries. That's going to be real interesting in the steel mills.
Yeah.
Decarbonizing, repairing, and improving transportation and other infrastructure. Yeah. Funding massive investment in the drawdown and capture of greenhouse gases. Really, we're gonna go down the carbon capture boondoggle rat hole again. Making green technology, industry, expertise, products, and services a major export of the United States with the aim of becoming the undisputed international leader in helping other countries transition to completely carbon-neutral economies and bringing about a global Green New Deal. Well, hey, did you see anything in there about not blowing up Appalachia anymore?
No.
Hashtag fuck the hillbillies.
Well, and see, I would like to know who's pushing this mantra.
Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Well, that
newly elected to Congress. I like her. I'll respect her. But the fact of the matter is, it remains the absolute truth that Appalachia is the cradle of climate change. And if you do not do something here, well, it don't come to nothing, Mr. Finch. It don't come to nothing.
Nothing against her. Congratulations on her win. But I see this is a case of, and I don't mean to be, you know, harsh, but newbie blind enthusiasm can mess you up every time. Is this to say that her ideas and goals are not noble? They are excellent. They are each and every one worthwhile, and there's room for more good, worthwhile things like, oh, I don't know, what you're talking about with the mountaintop removal, okay? But again, it comes down to getting your steps in order and your priorities set in a way that's manageable and achievable and you know, viable.
Right. So that first one there, 100% of national power generation from renewable sources. Well, groovy, but you know what? That's not going to do a damn thing to mountaintop removal in Appalachia because of the export market. There's lots of people that want to burn mountaintop removal coal across the ocean. The Netherlands does. Okay? They burn a shit ton of it. The Chinese. We send it all around the planet. So... Once again, Appalachia proves to be eminently forgettable. But we've run over a little bit. Let's get out of here, Scott, and we'll continue the conversation later.
Okay, you take care. Have a good rest of your week. Are you working Thursday, or are you going to stop yourself?
It's kind of up. It's kind of up in the air. There's a possibility we might go over to a big potluck, and that would be kind of fun.
Yeah, well, that would be fun. All right, man. Well, take care. And if everybody out there in the Horn family, if you're traveling for the upcoming holidays, drive gently and don't drink and drive and don't and drive.
Don't drink and drive. You might spill your drink.
That's right. There you go.
All right,
Bob.
Later, Scott.
See ya.
Bye now. And so we close the program. Thank you very kindly again to Otto for meeting Catherine's challenge. That means that we've got $180 to go. That's where we finish this evening. That means tomorrow is $380. And hopefully we'll not, maybe some of the overnight crew will, somebody on the overnight crew will knock it down. That would be awesome. Thanks to our all-volunteer staff. Thanks in the chat room this evening to Sparky and Steve. Thank you very kindly to our news ninjas. Thank you, Brother Deacon Asa. Welcome back to Fair Canada. Thank you very kindly, John Fox in Australia, Ben Birch, WhiteRoseSociety.org.
Thanks to the hardest working, bravest people I know, the men and women of Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. Thanks to each and every one of you who shares your precious finite time engaged in this little conversation. And thank you to all of you who do keep this on the air. Thank you. And always, 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 Gina, it's all for you. Later, y'all.